大家好啊，咁咧就我係 Stella 啦，我係Amplus 西九文化區管理局 Amplus 博物館嘅 Education Curator。咁咧就歡迎大家嚟臨今次嘅威尼斯雙年展嘅講座系列啦。咁咧就或者大家可能可以 refresh 下大家嘅 memories 啦。我哋第一次咧就係有Dr. Federica Martini 咧，就係講關於有關威尼斯雙年展嘅歷史嘅。咁我哋上個禮拜咧亦都有第二個講者，咁就係阿 Paul O'Neill。咁佢就係講有關即係雙年展嘅一啲嘅現象啦，特別係對於策展嘅一啲嘅影響啦。咁今日咧係我哋呢個講座系列嘅第三場啦。咁我哋咧就好高興啦，我哋今次咧其實就邀請咗過往啦參加過威尼斯雙年展香港嘅館嘅策展人啦，同埋藝術家嘅。咁咧就我哋嚟緊咧就會有兩個section 嘅。咁第一部分咧，第一個 section 咧，我哋咧就會邀請策展人上台咧，咁咧就一一介紹有關之前嘅即係嘅參與啦。咁跟住我哋會有討論嘅時間。咁跟住藝術家第二部分就係藝術家嗰個介紹嘅。咁我哋今日咧就即係所有嘅講者咧就包括有Keith 啦、Keith 曾啦、Sabrina 啦。Tobias Berger 啦、何兆基啦、Alan Bao 啦、陳友強啦、Map Office 啦，同埋Hiram Toh 同埋阿 Frog King 嘅。咁咧就我哋原先咧今日咧都有埋Norman Ford 嘅，但係佢好抱歉，佢啱啱咧今日好唔舒服，咁所以咧就嚟唔到 join 我哋嘅 discussion。咁我哋今日亦都好高興咧，就有我哋嘅 moderator 啦，有阿 Tina Pang， 咁佢係香港大學美術博物館嘅，咁咧就作為我哋嘅 moderator。咁我首先咧就請咗今次講座系列嘅即係頭一部分啦，策展人嗰 part 咧，咁就上台同埋阿 Tina 上台先嘅，唔該曬。
首先好多謝 Stella、Amplus 同埋 Winnie 安排呢個系列嘅講座啦。咁我頭一月咧，其實我準備咗英文咧，咁你冇可能介意我哋係兩個語言都用埋。咁我先講翻之前嗰兩個 talk， 同埋提一提即係少少啲我哋今日想希望可以提到啲問題啦。So I wanted to thank Amplus and Stella and Winnie especially for putting together this lecture series. As part of the series, we've had two different perspectives on the Venice Biennial. Federica Martini talked on the history of the exhibition and how the idea of national participation has evolved and its physical traces on the city. We also learned particularly how the biennial came to offer opportunities to show the current artistic trends of the time, even during periods of great historical or political upheaval. At a time when the art world seems so globalized, is there still a meaningful place for the national representation model of the Venice Biennale? The second talk in the series was a critique of the biennial phenomenon, in which Paul O'Neill argued that the biennial largely reinforces the positions of a small group of super curators and prevailing networks of artists, patrons, and collectors that act to sanction markets. He proposed alternative models that are based on longer-term engagement with specific issues versus the nomadic short-termism of the Biennale. Since biennials have become the dominant exhibition-making format model of the 21st century, what is its true value to artists, critics, and audiences? So the purpose of this panel is to have first-hand accounts from curators and artists about the experience of showing at Venice, with an aim to broaden our understanding of Venice from a Hong Kong perspective and perhaps to propose some ideas that might inform future participation. I put together a basic sort of table, this is just as a background, a basic table of the background against which Hong Kong was partaking or has been partaking in the Venice Biennale. So you see Hong Kong takes part in the 49th version in 2001, which was themed the Plateau of Humankind, and the curator was Harold Seaman. And you see the visitor numbers there, 243,000 visitors. Now, Harold Zeman is the legendary Swiss curator who, this was his last Venice Biennial, and he expanded the participation at Venice to include many countries from Asia. I just wanted to quote something from the Biennale Guide. The Visual Arts Biennale as a platform of humanity, this is the idea. In the 1950s, an exhibition entitled Family of Man traveled around the world. We would like to reconnect to this at the beginning of the new millennium, but the chances of all individuals constituting a family are not promising, despite the faith in globalization and the breaking down of all kinds of walls. Each day, new conflicts are born for ethnic, religious, or political reasons, which give rise to wars. Today's artists react differently to those of a decade ago. They no longer make sporadic assertions of their own identity, but appeal to what is eternal in man on the basis of local rootedness. This was penned by Harold Zeman, and it reveals some of the sort of idealism around his curating of that iteration of Venice. So you'll see that the next one, and these are all themes that each of the curators curating at Venice were given and had to bear in mind when they were putting together their own exhibitions. And that's up to the latest one in 2011. And with that, I shall introduce our speakers this afternoon. First, Zhang Daping, who's currently an associate professor in the School of Design at Hong Kong Polytechnic University. He's co-founder of Parasite Art Space, Mindful Design Lab at Hong Kong PolyU, and Choi Yun Village Livelihood Place, and he's published the Idiosyncratic Hong Kong Lifestyle of the Hong Kong Professor book series. He creates public art, installations, performances, photographs, and publications, and is an art critic. He's exhibited widely in Asia, Europe, and North America, including Guangzhou Biennial, and has participated in the Venice Biennial in different roles, such as a member of the study group in 2001, curator of the Parasite Collective in 2003, and as a member of its steering group in the Hong Kong Arts Development Council. Sabrina Fong has actively participated in cross-cultural multimedia activities since 1980. She's curated and organized a wide variety of cultural events to promote public art. While working as a pianist in New York in the 1980s, she established Sabrina Fong Gallery, curating a number of international art exhibitions. She returned to Hong Kong in 1990 and has organized and curated several not-for-profit art projects through SFFA, including HongKongArtWeb.com, Art Windows, ArtScope Hong Kong 2000, and various public programs in Hong Kong and other parts of Asia. She's an advisor to the Hong Kong City University Art Gallery since 1999 and was a member of the Museum Advisory Group of the Consultative Committee on West Kowloon in 2006-2007. Norman Ford, unfortunately, is unable to join us. So our third and final curator is Tobias Berger, who is known to many of you. He's been a curator at M+ since 2011. Prior to that, was chief curator at the Nam June Paik Art Center in Seoul, South Korea. From 2005 to 2008, he was managing director and curator at Parasite. And between 2003 and 2004, he was director of Art Space New Zealand in Auckland, New Zealand. In 2004, he was responsible for developing the concept for the New Zealand contribution to the Sao Paulo Biennial, and in the same year in New Zealand, he curated sections of the Auckland Triennial and Work It for the Art and Industry Biennial in Christchurch. Other international biennial projects include exhibitions organized Guangzhou, Busan, South Korea, and in 2002, Tobias was artistic director of the 8th Baltic Triennial of the International Art in Vilnius, Lithuania. So without further ado, I'd like to pass over to Zhang Daping.
Thank you. Thank you, Tina. Hello, 那年 Parasite 第二屆香港參與威尼斯嘅，咁第一屆因為我係嗰個學習小組其中一個成員，所以知道嗰邊嘅情況會係點樣嘅。咁於是乎喺嗰去完之後翻嚟，一路都諗其實威尼斯雙年展對香港個藝術發展有啲乜嘢幫助嘅咁。咁而 Parasite 嘅成立咧，正正就係希望可以 contribute 翻落去香港。發展當代藝術各方面嘅，咁所以嗰陣我哋喺 Parasite 嗰度咧，我哋定立咗有七個唔同嘅areas， 我哋係會做嘅，即係包括展覽啊、藝評啊、教育啊、社區藝術啦、啊，咁一籃子七樣嘢咁。所以喺威尼斯呢一個項目嗰度，我哋都係朝呢個方向去諗。咁咧內幕嘢就係話，初初諗住，哎呀唔好參加啦，因為即係都。好犀利啊嘛！你好大型，好多嘢要照顧，後來諗下，都係一個機會嚟嘅喎。咁於是乎，我就喺截止報名嗰晚咧，就通宵寫咗個 proposal。咁我仲記得咧，嗰陣咧就開始有 email system 冇耐嘅。咁我哋啲 members 都有個 email account， 我哋都喺上邊做咗一輪創作。好啦，咁我天光嘅時候寫好咗 proposal 咧，我就發咗個電郵俾大家，因為之前冇商量過嘛。咁我就話嗱，我有個咁嘅諗法，寫咗，咁就如果有興趣參加嘅咧，就中午前咧，你就 send 你個 CV 俾我，我就擺埋落去，咁我哋就去參加啦。咁即係到時有幾多人就幾多人啦。咁所以嗰朝早咧，有一啲我哋 Parasite 嘅 members 佢哋冇 check email， 因為嗰陣冇而家咁頻密咁啊 check 得，所以佢哋就後來先知道我哋報咗名嘅。咁但係因為佢名冇喺裏邊，所以佢哋就冇得去。咁呢個做法其實反映咗Parasite某一個做嘢嘅狀況，即係唔係風格咁巴閉，啲狀況嘅就係其實好 ad hoc 嚇。咁就係咁嘅情況之下咧，但係因為另外我哋有一個理念咧，就係話喺嗰個年代啊，香港做當代藝術，因為係發展咗冇耐，我哋都抱住一個踢街波嘅心態，就係吹雞嘅時候咧，你中意嚟就玩啦咁。你識踢又好，唔識踢又好，你幾專業都好，你幾渣都好，總之大家落場玩得開心就得噶啦。因為我都相信喺當代藝術嘅領域嗰度咧，每一個人咧，佢哋自己嘅做緊嘅嘢或者佢嘅專長咧，都可以係一種 contribution 嚟嘅。咁所以到最後咧。我哋去嗰年咧就好大棚人嘅，咁而呢大棚人裏邊咧有幾位咧當其時咧唔係藝術家嚟嘅，好啦，但係呢個諗法而家事隔十年睇翻轉頭，又幾有趣喎，因為喺嗰一棚人裏邊咧今日睇翻轉頭咧，當中其中一位之外咧，其他嘅咧而家都喺香港藝術圈唔同嘅範疇裏邊咧，係仲係一個好活躍嘅分子嚟嘅咁。咁所以我哋嗰年就去完之後就做咗咁啦。咁去嘅時候做嘢，因為我哋嗰班參與嗰班人咧，各方面嘅人都有，同埋頭先我講嘅，我哋有七個唔同領域，我哋去發展香港嘅當代藝術嘅。咁所以嗰次威尼斯嘅參與，無論喺嗰個設計，譬如大家見到呢個邀請卡啦、海報啊呢啲版面設計，以至嗰本長刊裏邊寫嗰啲分析文章，或者個展覽嘅策略。展覽的概念和展覽的 execution 都是我們那班那 team 隊叫做 Parasite Collective 那裡一起去做出來的，所以那個 collective 其實是 more than Parasite 原本那個成員的，大致是這樣的情況。於是乎我們就被 ADC 選了，這個是另外一個有趣的地方，我們原本寫的 proposal 不是做這個作品的，我的 proposal 裏面寫咧，我哋係想係租一架船喺船上邊做我哋嘅作品。咁呢個係嗰個被揀選嘅 proposal 嚟嘅。咁揀選咗之後，後來 ADC 就問我哋，如果佢哋需要我哋因應場地配合上咧作一個修改得唔得咧？咁於是乎我哋翻去商量過嘅時候咧，就覺得都可以一試喎咁。所以就到最後就完成了個作品了，係咯，我就講呢啲先啦，天啊！
各位你好，咁我都好開心咧。今次 M Plus organize 個費利斯雙年展，俾我哋重温下咁多年，我都差唔多唔記得咗我哋上一次去嗰陣時辦個情況啦。咁都好好玩嘅。咁主要我諗我同阿 Keep 嘅 angle 咧，就會喺另外一個 angle 嘅去諗啦。咁我哋辦係2005年嗰個辦嗰屆咧，就好古怪嘅，因為咧之前第一次同埋第二次嗰個 location 咧都係好近威尼斯雙年展嘅大展嘅位置嘅，就唔知點解嗰一次咧就突然間選咗一個位置咧係好遠嘅，係近 Rialto Bridge 嗰度嘅。咁嗰個都係我哋即係個係一個 struggle 一個情況，我哋要處理，因為我諗大家都知道啦，去威尼斯雙年展嘅時候咧，每個人係忙到不得了噶啦。咁啊之後你至多可能係得如果你一分鐘內，如果你個作品唔可以 capture 嗰啲人咧，人已經行過咗噶啦。即係如果你喺個大會裏邊，咁如果你係嗰啲 out of 即係個 main site 嗰啲 pavilion 咧。除非你是啲特別嘅國家，一般嚟講咧，好少人會特登為咗香港館咧行幾千里路去。咁我成日都即係嗰陣時我哋去參與個展覽時候，我哋就喺度諗啦，即係其實 location 咧係最重要嗰一個依個咁一國家，即係咁國際性嘅一個展覽啦。咁但係我哋已經第一步已經輸咗啦，大輸啦，因為其實唔係。其實好笑咧，就係唔係外邊嘅人揾唔到，我哋自己嘅人咧喺嗰度做緊展覽嘅時候咧，都會蕩出路嘅。咁但又好有趣嘅地方咧，你剛剛睇到嗰、那個頭先有個 slide 咧，就係、是、但係咧，我哋因為嗰個館好大，成個 building 咁樣嘅，咁佢咧就喺、是、個 Grand Canal 嗰度嘅。咁所以如果個個人行過喺船上面行過咧，就一定會見到啊。但係見到你入唔到去嘅喎，因為你喺隔離，就算你個船站喺隔離咧。都是你會 lost 咗，因為佢要兜好多路。咁所以依個係嗰陣時我哋入去即係諗住去做嘅時候，應該點樣處理咧？咁但係based on 翻個 location， 咁我哋就盡量玩咗個 building 啦。咁成個 building 咧就好有趣、好大下嘅。咁嗰陣時我哋就大家同埋兩位 artist 咧就一起 brainstorm 啦。咁有啲咩係比較有趣啲咧？咁亦都我係會好有興趣咧，係會揾。去 select 一啲比較有趣啲嘅 artist 咧，佢哋自己本身咧係會發產生一啲一齊做呢個展覽嘅時候會產生一啲特別嘅energy 啦、chemistry 啦，咁同埋做嘅作品出嚟咧，我都係好期待嘅一啲會有一啲好 surprise 嘅 element 出嚟。咁所以咧，我哋依一個作品，我哋咧就想係成個 building 咧係去係好 site specific 嘅一個作品嚟嘅。咁入，因為佢係分開個 building 裏邊係分開兩邊，咁所以我哋主要咧就係前面一邊啦，同埋後邊嗰邊咧，儘量係有一個連貫性咁樣嘅情況嘅。咁出嚟嘅時候咧，如果我哋個 slide 可以喐咧，咁樣就你會睇到入去就係阿 Sandy 嘅作品啦。咁所以佢依個咧就係有紅白藍嘅，跟住咧就係阿陳玉強嘅作品咧，就係佢一個倒轉嘅一個威尼斯嘅，佢將一個倒轉嘅威尼斯嘅城市咧就行咗出嚟嘅，即係佢 build 咗係倒翻轉咁樣出嚟嘅。咁所以成個好似一個 journey 咁咧入去咧，係有一個 path 俾你咁樣兜個圈行翻出嚟嘅一個作品。咁我哋嗰陣時咧，記得係 ADC 咧都要我哋好着重於嗰個 representing Hong Kong 嗰個 element 嘅。咁我哋因為都知道啦，依一個展覽個 location 嘅關係咧，如果我哋要會有好多 audience 能夠嚟咧，唯一咧就係靠 opening 嗰日咧係會有多啲 event 咧。就會有啲人有啲理由要嗰日要 make 我哋嗰個 show 啦，咁可能亦都係如果佢 opening 嚟咧，就係嗰一次佢會嚟啦。咁所以我哋嗰一次嗰個 opening 咧，我哋就做咗好多特別嘅 performance 啦。咁啊，小梅咧就幫我哋做咗個 performance， 同埋龚志成啦，同埋雅思咧，亦都係就 Hong Kong culture 咧俾咗一個 talk 嘅。咁成件即係成變一個 opening 咧，變咗盡量嘅。做一個 more than just 一個art opening 咁樣嘅一個 event 咧，希望可以 attract 到即係當時因為個個人都好忙嘅 opening 嗰幾日咧，就個個都好多 event 要去，咁就去做咗即係會可以 attract 到啲 audience 出嚟，咁亦都大家亦都有少少感覺到啲香港比較係頂尖嘅成個 multicultural 嘅element 啦，有 dance 有 music 同埋關於香港 culture 嘅事情嘅，咁。 係咪冇咁多時間 ？OK， 咁我諗我哋即係暫停啦，就喺依度，即係大家有少少 idea， 即係我哋嗰次係個展覽係點樣啦。
OK， yeah， that's okay. Can I just have that? yeah, it's quite nice to sit here in the Space Museum together with Keith and everybody on the stage. I never thought that would happen. because when Keith... I listen to myself, that's not good. No, because when Keith was talking, I was thinking that I think one of the reasons I came to Hong Kong, not directly, is because of the Biennial, because Parasite, in that time, first participated in the Venice Biennial, and then later in the Gwangju Biennale with all the other independent spaces. And I think that was when also thinking started to change something in Parasite and to hire an independent curator. So it is if we talk about these biennales, they have many different implications. So let's talk first about the one Toda Pak Shanchuan's Biennale we did together. And I think what is important for all of us sitting here is you don't do that alone. You certainly do it with the artist, but you also have a big team behind you. And in my case, it was Jung Ma who helped a lot and who was almost the co-curator, who was basically the co-curator of that show, because I was already, when the real hard work started, I already had started my job in Korea. And so Jung Ma was here with Toda running that exhibition, or basically putting it together. I think, and here you see certain pictures of that Biennale, and I want to end with that picture of me looking much younger and better, basically playing with that money. And it is a nice picture because this piece is very important for that exhibition. It is basically, I think it's 10 kilograms of 10 cent pieces from Hong Kong. And as you know, as you may not know, the picture on these 10 cent pieces changed before the handover. It was the Queen's portrait that was on it. And afterwards was certainly the Hong Kong emblem, the Bohemia, which is on it. And for Toda, this piece is a really nice way of showing how slowly things change and how slowly things change from a very English place to a very Hong Kong place. And I think that's the great thing about Toda. It is these little things. He finds these little stories and these little ideas and shows them. And that is why I think Toda was a great choice for that biennial, because what you want to have at a biennial is you want something that is local, that is somehow talks about local issues, but maybe something that is not representative, and I think we can talk about that later. So you want something that works also on a very global context, that plays with an international language, so to speak. You try to transport a local idea, a local mood and situation into a very global exhibition. And Venice is a very global exhibition, and Toda is very good in exactly that. I mean, I wouldn't call Toda Park a political artist, but he comes certainly out of a certain generation, and he comes out of a certain feeling, and he manages to bring things up and to talk about things that makes everybody very aware about his place and his idea in society, and his political ideas. And I think that's one of the great qualities about it. And yes, I don't think a biennial artist has to be a big representative. It's not a tourist promotion exhibition. I think it is an exhibition that is on an international level where you can talk about local things. Some of them before that have done it. I mean, Map Office have done it, Kurt have done it, all in a very, very nice context. But you don't have to. It shouldn't be it has to be attached to that. And I think the idea also was, this was the first time we actually had a solo presentation. And that was a consequence out of the three artists' participation before. But also in general, it is Venice is a huge group exhibition. And to make a group exhibition in a group exhibition is always very challenging. And I really wanted to make a point in my application and saying, I believe in that artist and I believe in Toda. He's perfectly at that time. he had started to work with Vitamin Space. He had had international exhibition. People got recognized him. So it was a perfect time also to say we only do one artist and we do that and we do it right and we put all the resources into that artist. And I had worked with Tosa before in different exhibitions, but he had this kind of this critical mass by them. And I think that's also the beauty about Hong Kong. It is not in a lot of countries, the biennial participation, that's kind of the highlight of your entire career. It's like a big museum retrospective, and there's a lot of pressure on it. And Hong Kong, we somehow managed to have it always in a good time, when artists kind of developed and when they were in a really interesting stage of their career. And I think that's something I really appreciate on the Hong Kong's participations. But it is also about the environments. And as I said, not every artist, there are artists that are very, very important in a certain society, in a certain environment, but they wouldn't work in Venice. And then there are other artists that are too, maybe too local and so on. So it is very important of who you put in there and how you play with that. And I think that was that worked very well with that. And I mean, it also gave us this possibility. I'm sorry, I left it over there, but you see that big yellow book there. We could make a book like other artists did a book before. It gave you this possibility to develop and to work on. And I think that beside, I was very lucky to have a very flexible sponsor because a lot of services in Venice you don't get a receipt for, and I had really this money that I could spend very easily. So in the end, Tosa's show was a lot about traveling, and it was really thinking about, and Tosa's work is about taking things and ideas and so on from one place to another. And I think that was also the strategy. We had some older works of him, but he also went to Venice, he went to Italy, he did some new works. And so the show became a very nice mix and I think was appreciated because we had some works that we knew would work very well, which were very strong, but we also had some new works. And in the end, I think that that was what happened in Venice and why it went well, because Tosa really worked on it. He really went to Venice a few times. He lived there for 2 months or something like that before. Jung Ma and I worked on it in a very productive way. And in the end, we all developed on that project. I think Tosa developed and had great shows afterwards and helped not only his career but also his practice. It helped Jung and me. And we also, for the first time, invited venue participants from Hong Kong to come to Venice and stay there, which I think was a very good thing. And we kept that. I mean, it kept going with that. And that's one of the things you want to change. And you don't want only have an Italian, you know, an Italian person sitting there that have no idea about Hong Kong. You want Hong Kong people to represent Hong Kong, but also them to learn about Venice and to learn about this great exhibition. So all in all, I think it was for everybody a very rewarding experience.
Thank you, Tobias. You Tang. Yeah, it's another
Hong Kong. What do you want to?
Okay.
Oh, you have to talk about.
Okay. I'm sorry, I'm old. 剛才大家如果記得那個介紹就是我自己跟這個威尼斯相連戰就千絲萬縷大家相信都不知道為什麼我自己就知道很清楚因為我第一次學習小組去的時候我就發了一個誓那個誓就是什麼呢就是未去威尼斯之前都有很多美好想像嘛威尼斯很漂亮的地方那我去完那次之後呢 發覺原來很怕威尼斯於是乎回程的時候就發了一個誓就說我以後都不去威尼斯誰不知連續都要繼續去所以如果你問我還會不會去的話我說一定去但是這次跟藝水會 Benny 和黃純傑一起 curate 蛙王這個展覽這個就對於我自己來講就很大意義的因為蛙王是我的老師來的我18歲那年就認識他就在理工讀書的時候認識他所以他是我恩師來的一直有一個因為他對我那個藝術的實踐影響很大的簡單點說如果沒有蛙王其實是沒有 Parasite 的跟著一 往後所有的東西都不會有我就知道他老人家有個心願經常都想去威尼斯參加這個展覽 咁所以咧，其實喺好幾年之前咧，我同阿 Benny 咧一直都有傾呢個諗法。咁後來因緣際會底下，我哋就決定話就試下呢一屆就去試下做啦咁。咁我自己其實嗰個時期咧，我就已經唔再喺香港藝術圈嗰度做藝術噶啦。咁我去咗另外一啲地方度做藝術噶啦。咁呢個都係老師嘅影響嚟嘅。咁但係因為為咗呢一個一個好機會去報答老師啊嘛，於是乎硬著頭皮去多一次啦。咁今次就好好啦。好嘅意思就係呢一 team 拍檔咧係好犀利嘅，即係 Benny 啦、黃成傑啦，跟住藝穗會成班同事咧，佢哋係好專業嘅。咁所以我今次去成個過程裏邊係行行企企嘅啫。咁再加上即係蛙王嗰個做藝術個風格咧，根本就唔使人哋理噶嘛。咁所以就成個過程就好享受啊！就企喺旁邊，咁得閒見阿老師想揾人陪佢玩咁，同佢玩下咁。咁所以都幾開心嘅一次。咁同埋。又睇得到呢啲所謂老一輩藝術家咧，除咗年紀大之外，其實冇什麼嘢係老嘅，即係好 contemporary 喺成個作品裏邊咧，都睇到嗰種活力啊！即係不單止係佢個人嗰種活力，而係成個香港嘅活力都喺曬嗰度。咁所以係好開心嘅一個經驗咯，今次。咁關於呢個，或者我講到呢度先啦。咁反而 Parasite 係啊，呢個就係喺嗰度玩嗰啲情況啫。係啦，咁或者啱啱我哋 Q&A 你可以再傾多啲。
好多謝大家。頭先你提過你好怕威尼斯呢一個地方，有冇？好啊。咁其實我哋提起威尼斯就有幾樣嘢諗嘅，即係威尼斯一個現象，即係雙年展呢一個。現象啦，又提過城市啦，咁可唔可以講一講少少，即係你哋做策展人嗰個諗法，你會唔會考慮第一雙年展呢個現象，同埋威尼斯嗰個地方？
其實我成日覺得威尼斯咧係一個好叻嘅地方嚟嘅，因為佢除咗佢 tourist 靠嚟認為即係 tourist 太多啦，會擲沉咗佢之外咧，咁佢就處理咗兩個有好每一年有個雙年展啦，一係 architecture 或者係 visual 啦，仲有一個電影展啦。咁我哋咧就係愛與恨嘅，對於威尼斯唔去佢又唔得。去咧，佢其實樣嘢咧就係唔好，即係我覺得真係做咗咁多十年嘅一個雙年展，冇可能咧啲作品你如果遲一個月去咧，已經冚爛曬噶啦。佢又冇去冇人去 maintenance 啊，同埋佢係一個即係佢好成功嘅咧，就係、是、你乜嘢咧都要靠佢哋當地嘅，即係你點樣咧，你運嘢好拆嘢好，又要佢要用翻佢啲船啦，冚唪佢即係成個城市，即係佢好知道自己係。在一個位置上你沒有它是不行的，但是我覺得如果以一個藝術的 angle 來說，即是它是你在如果你的展覽在那裡或者藝術家在那裡展過發放過展覽，你已經 immediately 因為是一個雙年展有很多人去看，很多是藝術界裡面的人去看到，所以個 exposure 呢是沒有說可以比較低一些。但當然現在是譬如這五六年那些所有的 fair 都是很重很多很多出來，所以又有另外一個世即是另外一個情況了。
Yeah, I mean,Venice has two parts. I mean, first there are these completely maniac 4 days where literally the whole art world is flying in and fighting about cocktails and beds and parties and all that. And then on the Sunday, and that is the amazing thing, it stops. And then this biennale goes on for another 4 months, and nobody goes. It's completely empty, and it's a completely different experience. And which is also, I mean, it's difficult for the exhibitions, because some exhibitions work very, very well with a lot of people, but some of them, like the one, the Lee Kidd exhibition, which we'll be talking about next week, works much better with very few people. But there is nothing, I mean, for anybody who has not been to Venice, just you have to go. It's the most amazing thing in the world, and I like it, and that might sound a bit spoiled or whatever, but Venice changes in these 4 days of the openings. It becomes that kind of old, sophisticated place. I mean, normally if you go in a normal time to Venice, San Marco Square is empty, the coffee shops, the coffees and everything is empty, because it has mostly backpack tourists and so on. But when all these people come in with their super yachts and their private jets and so on, it does bring you, it makes you get into palaces you never get into. You get into places you just never experience, and it is this kind of complete, one can say, decadent, but also beautiful way of experiencing Venice, which you can only have in these 4 days.
I just want to add something to that, actually. I mean, you said that Venice is divided into two parts, and I think that's part of the criticism, that these first 4 days, they are for this kind of the super curators, the patrons, the collectors, and the Venice has turned into something of a marketplace described broadly. I mean, Sabrina mentioned this very important point about the architectural fragility of Venice. And it's interesting that this year, Anne Summers Cox, who is the managing publisher of the Art newspaper, who's done a lot of publishing on Venice over the years and on the art market and the art world in general, she sits on the Venice in Peril board, or she resigned recently, but she's working simultaneously to try and preserve Venice as a city, and proposing that there should be this tourist tax for everyone who comes in from outside, and that would include people coming for Venice. But then on the other hand, I mean, the art newspaper itself is reporting on, and I don't think it's proper to be too sanctimonious about this, but reporting on the fact that lots of artworks being shown in the current Venice Biennial, although we're talking about the past entries, but the current Venice Biennial have been sold, and that some subsequently that many of the galleries at Basel, maybe this is something that we can talk about, many of the galleries at Basel that are representing those particular artists are in fact very coy about it, and they don't wish to discuss it. Now, Federica Martini, in her talk, she made a very interesting point about the history of Venice, which is it was, when it was founded, a selling exhibition. It was intended to be self-sustaining in that sense. But so there is this sort of feeling that maybe Zena Pin can talk to this, but it is not necessarily a kind of democratic art experience, or it's a sort of that it is focused very much around these first 4 days, and then everyone leaves, and then but the other thing that I want to mention, that maybe for those of you who have not been to Venice and haven't experienced Venice, is that when you see on this map, the Biennale itself is divided into two parts. So there's the Giardini in the garden with the national pavilions, and then there's the Arsenale where the curated exhibition is. And within the Giardini section, there's the Italian pavilion, which also has the curated exhibition. So we're talking about a whole kind of constellation. And in the previous slides, you'll see that there's a whole constellation of activities. There's the official exhibition, and then the unofficial national pavilions. And all of those unofficial national pavilions are taking place in historic houses and, as Tobias said, these places that you ordinarily don't have access to. Those are all free. So you can go, as a sort of general person just showing up in Venice, you can visit all of these amazing art exhibitions for free and take part in these so-called kind of collateral events.
Yeah, and but that I have to. Oops, I mean, it's not, it's a bit even more complicated because some of the country pavilions in the cities are actually part of the official biennial, while you have the collateral events are not the country participations. That is why Hong Kong, Taiwan, Scotland, North Island, all these are collateral events, because they are not countries. And it comes out of that very old tradition of it being almost like a world exhibition. Going back to that gallery thing, on the one side, certainly things get sold in Venice, but also the gallerists pay a lot of money for a lot of times. A lot of times, the things you see there are paid. Massimiliano Gioni, who was a curator this year, if he invites a lot of these artworks for his exhibitions, they cannot pay that. The biennial is not rich enough to pay that. So they go to the gallerist and they ask the artist and the gallerists to pay these installations. So a lot of gallerists, yes, they make money there, but a lot of gallerists also lose a lot of money there. And I know a lot of, especially young gallerists that are participation, and you know they have to fork out 600,000 Hong Kong for an artist to not to be there, but for an installation there. So there are these two parts of it. And yes, it's a global art market. Certainly, certain things get sold, and certain things. I don't think it's actually a huge problem because it's not selected according to that. I mean, the national pavilions, sure. I mean, sure, Germany has a bigger pavilion than Hong Kong because Germany has more money. So is that democratic? No, but it is. But then sometimes remember Singapore. I mean, that was the reason. Mm-hmm. The reason you didn't have the pavilion at that time was because Singapore basically stole the Hong Kong pavilion, and then
But they have it for 2 years.
Yeah, they had it for 2 years, and then. But the funny thing is, then they wanted to become bigger and bigger, and they went into that huge palace, mm-hmm. and Hong Kong was lucky enough to get back to our old space, and now we have a 10-year lease on it. Hong Kong has it because we know this is the best. Hong Kong has the best location for a collateral event, right in opposite of the Arsenal.
Right. 真係盲中聽埋聽埋好多嘢,咁親歷其境嘅時候,你就會引證到有啲嘢原來係傳說,有啲嘢係真嘅,跟住你親身體驗香港去到嗰度,原來發覺,喂,呢啲都係一啲所謂即係globalization裏面嘅一啲好即係權力拉扯嘅嘢,跟住你就知道香港係冇得拉㗎嘛。 咁就係咁一個現實,你呢一世你係香港人嚟㗎喎,我唔可以好似Tobias咁,佢可以話真係可以係一個國際嘅level,可以做到佢嘅practice嘅。即係爭得平個名,全香港700萬人知道曬都好啦,我都去唔到嗰個level㗎嘛。咁明白咗呢嘅時候,咁咪可以好清楚咁做自己想做嘢,譬如話第一次Paradise
就好清楚知道我係要希望多啲香港嘅藝術圈或者非藝術家人多啲人親身去到，然之後搞清楚呢個係乜嘢一件事。所以頭先講嗰啲問題完全可以對於我嚟講係冇關係，所以我都冇興趣。咁好啦，咁啊知道咗之後，跟住呢班參加咗之後嘅人，佢哋將來喺佢哋個藝術事業上點樣發展咧，咁佢哋自由自己有佢哋嘅路。 然之後另外一次就係因為要報答恩師,報答出恩師就得咯,所以就好舒服。亦都唔使理嗰啲咁複雜,而且你係無能為力嘅事嘛。你講當代藝術就係一個全球化嘅現象嚟㗎嘛。正如而家咁,我哋喺度講當代藝術,點會有即時傳譯啫?就係咁嘅一個現象嚟㗎嘛,你唔可以話,咁樣係民主啲呀,定抑或 以至大會要求,譬如說,曾德平,你今次上來要講英文,不可以講廣東話,如果我想上來講話的時候,我說, I can speak English,
就行了,所以我對不起,沒什麼興趣在這方面。我明白,如果是談到整個藝術圈子,國際化,就是globalization這件事,或者internationalization, 咁喺呢一個情況以下，即係做一個，你頭先都提過啦，即係做一個香港畫家，或者做一個即係藝術家，或者係想代表香港，即係又唔可以話代表。咁但係作為一個藝術家啦，咁喺呢一個環境之內，即係有啲咩感受？
有咩感受啊？
或者策展人，
哦，
策展人的角色
好大嘅，啲講就大到唔識講噶啦。即係嗱，因為即係識咗呢啲老師咧，佢知道佢話到俾你聽，藝術最犀利嘅係咩地方啊？藝術就係你嘅生活啊嘛。有咩大得過呢樣咧？冇啊，冇嘅時候咁你咪好似好開心咁，去到邊度都可以做藝術咯。踢街波亦都係嘅，即係你明知自己個水準就係街波水平，咁你唔會諗住自己可以參加世界盃噶嘛？其實就係咁嘅啫，咁你明白咗之後，咁你咪踢得開心啲咯。或者我頭先講，香港有個藝術圈嘅，係叫做藝術圈嘅，有好多呢啲議題嘅咁。咁我冇興趣嘅時候，我就跳出咗啲藝術圈。但係因為即係老師教藝術同生活係同一樣嘢，咁於是乎我有命嗰日咧，我原來都喺度繼續做緊藝術嘅時候，咁亦都唔使咁去諗頭先嗰啲好犀利嗰啲問題啊！咁你國際化係無可避免嘅一件事嚟嘅，係嘛？咁你知道無可避免，咁你唔使去避咯。咁你連呢個精神都唔使花喺嗰度。
但係國際化咧，就有一個毛病，特別喺好似威尼斯咁樣一個情況啦，即係佢係會將啲嘢係好似拉平咗，即係 homogenizing 一個 effect 咁樣。咁喺呢一個，即係我哋點帶到出嚟一個好即係 authentic 嘅一個 experience 咁樣？呢個都係一個問題。
即係從藝術俾到觀眾有 authentic 嘅 experience， 冇㗎，點會有可能嘅啫？呢啲唔會咁發生嘅。即係又用翻踢街波咁，你如果你永遠都坐喺上面睇人踢波，你咪可以講粗口鬧，你可以拍掌，你可以做人海，乜都得。但你要有一個踢球的 authentic experience， 就要落場踢才行的嘛。那我就喜歡落場踢那種人，所以我
雙年展的情況，我覺得有一個陰
影。跟那人第一次來香港的時候，我約他見面都約在修頓球場。我就告訴你 Parasite 的精神就是修頓球場的精神。後來原來我們一直聊的時候發覺，原來土巴是喜歡踢政府大球場的，他是國家隊那種水平的，於是覺得Parasite 沒有請錯人了，那這是 world class curator。
其實 Parasite 是參加了很多屆的了，其實 你會覺得 Parasite 雙年展其實
最衰又唔話得事
嘅，我係優點啦，即係我覺得係真係
走添啊！陳玉強真係嬲，唔係老人家急尿。
Too much soccer
係真係鼓勵啲獨立策展人，或者係即係比較獨立少少一個心態。
嗱，呢個我覺得係香港做得好好嘅，一開始佢。佢係公開咁樣招募，
喂，
你諗下我啲踢街波嘅時候，邊有資格去威尼斯嘅啫？如果唔係香港藝發局咁樣咁開明咯。
係啊，我覺得依個就係嗰陣時當時藝發局嗰個概念係好，因為我哋就想培養香港嘅 curator。咁嗰陣時就開始咗參與依個威尼斯雙年展，我覺得依個好重要，因為真係帶到香港嘅藝術家去到一個好國際嘅一個 platform 嗰度。咁因為我相信喺49屆嗰個威尼斯雙年展之前啊，冇乜人太多人對香港藝術家 Hong Kong artist 依樣嘢咧，會或者特別有興趣或者知道係乜嘢。咁我覺得肯定咧，去到我哋就算2005年嘅時候咧，我做完咗之後咧，我哋有一個即係我哋有個comeback 嘅時候，我哋冚唪嗰啲 mailers 咧，我哋收到好多人咧係第。第二啲喎，國際性嘅 curator 問我啊，你可唔可以話俾我聽，即係香港仲有啲咩香港藝術家啊咁？咁我覺得依個係好，依個係我覺得真係最 encouraging 嘅一件事咯。即係依個每一年我哋咁樣每兩年啊帶一個定藝術家一個香港館，咁人哋知道有一個叫香港藝術家。咁 by this time 而家就已經我哋係喺依個即係同依個成個世界好似有 少近咗好多啦。咁樣，我覺得依個嗰陣時，
我覺得呢個即係你要歸功於張仲仁嘅。哇！我係學習小組啊嘛，咁跟住佢過去咧，真係學識好多嘢。佢係呼風喚雨嗰種 curator 嚟嘅，即係你喺嗰個場合頭先聽大家聽到陶伯斯佢講嗰個真係世界級，好多人唔睬你嘅場合，佢可以請到全亞洲嘅嚇重要人物就嚟食一餐飯。咁當然啦，最重要令到頭先Sabrina講嗰種香港藝術可以呈現到出嚟，就係嗰一屆張仲仁揀咗三位好好嘅香港藝術家嘛。何兆基、白安倫同梁志和啊嘛。咁所以嗰一次我就感受就非常之大啦。就咧，我睇到咧，我哋香港藝術家嘅水平咧，完全係不下於其他國家嘅。但唯獨是就係、是、即係全球化呢啲咁嘅文化權力嘅關係嘅時候，香港就係冇嘢嘅。咁呢個亦都係點解我哋喺帕洛西參加嘅時候定個題目叫做 Navigating the Dot， 因為喺世界地圖上邊咧，香港係一點嚟嘅。但喺世界藝術地圖上邊咧，香港你係揾唔到香港。所以你要去 navigate， 呢個係一個事實，即、就、係、是、我參與咗兩次之後見到個事實嚟。
Yeah， and we have to also get away from sure it's about Hong Kong and we talk about Hong Kong， but it's about the art world is so much more about people and networks and friendships and the great thing about Parasite going there with 15-20 people, the great thing about Sabrina's big event in this great Grand Hotel and so on is that you bring people together, but you also going there, you also have an initiative for a lot of people to go, because it's not only that the curator and the artist goes, yet we now have the venue attendants, you have the collectors. I mean, I think we had like 50-60 people this year, or every year that are going, and this is a network that is building up, and an international network that is fantastic, and I think that's what really is the beauty about it. And it's sure, it works on this national level, because that's how Venice works. I mean, it is this country participation, but it also works a lot about a network, a friendship, to meet new people, to see new people, and to have all these new things. And we should, I think, that is maybe in the end a much more important thing than if it's you know, a Hong Kong participation, a Taiwan participation, or something like that.
Thank you. I wonder if there are any questions from the audience. Down at the front.
Thank you for coming and taking the time to speak to us. I was curious to understand, so it sounds like the Arts Development Council is the decision-making body for who goes. So everyone has to apply. I mean, I don't understand the process of how, you know, each of you were able to become involved, or if you could talk a little about that.
You're partly right. They openly recruit proposals, but they have this independent panel to assess the proposals. So the decision is not made by the ADC, but it's recommended by the panel.
Which then was changed this year, and that was why there was a little bit of controversy, because this year I think the ADC found out, or whatever, they wanted to change the system, and then they did change the system, and for this year there was a new system. The ADC appointed M+, the organization I'm working now for, to curate it for this time. Again, we will evaluate that afterwards and see how things go forward. So in the first five times it was an open call for proposals. People, I don't know how many, Tina, you were in these groups, or how many people put in proposals, like 20, 30, 40,
not that many. No. I mean, the application process, I think everyone who's applied knows the application process is quite onerous, and it's a short period of time that you have to apply, and all of the
bits and pieces need to be in place. So you have to have a curator and the artist and the concept and the proposal and the budget and so on. So it's quite an onerous. It's a big project and it needs to be a professional presentation, or I shouldn't use the word professional, but it needs to be a substantial presentation. And I think that already cuts out quite a lot of people. But I don't know. I guess year on year it differs. But
You go ahead.
Oh, no, I had the Burger Collection as a sponsor, and that helped me a lot because I could do that book, the pre-opening party, and things like that. And as I said, Italy is not known for giving you a receipt for everything they do for you, right? And this is problematic if you have to get all the money back from the ADC, because they only give you money back you have receipts for. And there are huge. There was always huge problems with money in the Venice Biennial, and I think. In my case, I really, because I had this very generous sponsor, but I only got them after I was appointed. I didn't propose my project with a sponsor on board. I had the project, and then I went out to look for a sponsor, and I got lucky. I know with others, they just didn't have time.
Actually, getting sponsors is a little difficult because the Biennale are very strict with commercial sponsors. So it has to be some kind of a non-profit organization, and it would not advertise it anywhere. You can't put the sponsor on any of the publicity.
Yeah.
I want to go back a little bit to thinking about the city of Venice and presenting art within the city of Venice, because I think that those of you, I don't know how many people have actually been to Venice here. Just put up your hands. 50%. Less, I think, less than 50%.
Oh, you have to go.
but the experience, the actual experience of being in Venice and visiting the exhibitions at Venice is, it's like a marathon. You know, you pace yourself, you get up early, you make sure you have pit stops, food, drink, you know, or comfortable shoes. And within this sort of context of trying to see, it's also a question I have about whether Venice can still be considered kind of contemporary. That's another question, whether it's still sort of pushing the new boundaries of art and ideas and the issues that we're thinking about today within its confines, because it's quite a restricted place, both in terms of the National Pavilion and in terms of thinking about the architecture of the city and the historic nature of the city. You have lots of distractions. You have the beauty of the city itself. You have the churches, its own museums, which are very good. And within that context, audience ability to actually engage with artworks is relatively limited. And this seems to privilege certain types of media. And how has that sort of gone into the thinking of your own curating or thinking about what works? I mean, you mentioned this earlier, what works and what doesn't work at Venice. And this is maybe useful for people who are thinking about projects for situations like this, not just Venice, but also for other biennials.
Actually, I think at this stage in age, all biennales are so mega and so immense that it's like a marathon. So not just Venice at this point, but Venice, of course, is very big too. But the nice thing about Venice is the city is very attractive. And so even if you are running from A to B, you still can enjoy it. But if you go to other biennales, it's just like just as crazy or swell, and now with art fairs and then the sub fairs, it's like if you're in the art business or art circle, you're always running around like crazy. And for those who goes there during the openings, as Tobias says, it's more like a networking, socializing, meeting a lot of artists, very exciting. It's a totally different atmosphere. But for those going there later to see the exhibition, I think you can take it very easy, because this year, for instance, I decided I'm not going to go to this mad rush with a hotel booking and all the parties and everything. And instead, I'm going there actually this evening, so I can take my time and enjoy all the shows, and before they all turn, something goes wrong with them. And I think it's a very, very nice experience.
I think we have to think about the importance of Venice. Sure, Venice and Documenta are still the two exhibitions, the world exhibition. Documenta only happens every 5 years, and Castle Venice happens every 2 years. But they are not the only ones anymore, right? Like 10 years ago, that was it, right? There was almost, these were the two exhibitions that matter. And nowadays, with Guangzhou, Busan, they're like 70, but they're like, say, 10 really important biennials, Sydney, Yokohama, Istanbul, all these. So like the art fairs, like Basel is not the only big art fair anymore. There's Art Hong Kong and so on. The world, this global world, has dramatically changed. And that is the beauty about it, that there are all these different voices, and that Hong Kong art Hong Kong looks different than Art Basel, and that Venice looks different than Guangzhou and then Busan and so on. So I think we should, instead of always, you know, picking on that and saying that's bad and oh, go poor Venice, I mean, we should just say, look, this is it's kind of the grandmother. It's the first Biennale, it's over 100 years old, it has a totally antique system with national pavilions, nobody believes in anymore, but there are 20 other Biennales, so cool, let's keep it as kind of a monument of a world exhibition, which we just don't have anymore.
You don't want to say something about media privileging certain types of artworks?
Well, that's true. Actually, as an artist, I think it's really not fair for the artwork when you're in part of the Biennale like that, because you are your work is placed next to so many things: noise, sound, visual, light, everything. So it's really difficult, even as somebody who goes all the time, whatever the work did not attract me within like 30 seconds, you start walking to the next one. So it's not fair. It's 30 seconds too long?
3 seconds.
But on the other side, I mean, that's in the Biennale, in the big Arsenale pavilion, in the Italian pavilion. And then you have, as I said, I think there are works that work better in Venice than other works. There's artworks that are very important, as I said, here in Hong Kong, which I don't think you could just transplant to Venice, right? I mean, take our hero, Louis Chan, right? If you would show something like Louis Chan in Venice, nobody would get it, right? Even, okay, it's an older example, but I don't want to use newer ones. You have to know what you're into, and you have to understand this environment. You have to understand what, you know, where the people come from, and so on. But I think actually Hong Kong did quite a good job in that in the last 10 years. That I don't think there was one participation where I thought like, whoa, there it got completely wrong or something like that.
How many questions?
Earlier on, someone asked how many had attended the Venice Biennale, and you know, there's like less than 20% of people here. So how then, you know, the locals experience the Venice Biennale and the Hong Kong Pavilion when, you know, the work's been showcased there? Has it been brought back to Hong Kong and, you know, exhibited here? And then, of course, you are using words like globalizations, internet. I mean, you have social networks, you know, whether you have used other media to, you know, let the locals experience what is happening in Venice Biennale. I think I'm quite concerned, you know, when focus is so much on site. But how about, you know, back to Hong Kong itself? Yeah, if it's because now you're talking about the art world and then things that is so abstract to the locals. But my question is, you know, how have you thought about, you know, bring it back to the people here?
你哋嗰屆
有
冇
個有回應展嘅呢一樣嘢嘅？呢個係個要求，即係入 proposal 嘅時候個要求。咁但係要回應展唔係等於將原本本個作品擺翻嚟香港咁。咁我自己覺得個回應展其實冇意思嘅，即係用翻踢波為例啫嘛，你派對。國家隊出去踢，踢完之後，喂，你翻嚟踢多一場一模一樣得唔得？咁唔得噶嘛，即係咁。所以就算你現場直播都好啦，其實你以為自己現場，因為其實唔係現場，咁係睇電視嘅啫。所以嗰個係冇乜辦法嘅，其實講到尾。
我哋嗰屆咧，我哋都有做到一個回應展嘅。咁我哋就同阿 Keith 一樣，即係唔可能將個作品帶到嚟，但係亦都起碼咧，我哋帶到同樣嘅藝術家做好類似嘅嘢。咁起碼有嗰個少少嘅感覺。咁即係如果一個以香港嘅一個觀眾，咁起碼佢知道啊，有咁上下嘅嘢發生過喺威尼斯。咁當時喺嗰個展場喺 museum 嘅時候展覽嘅時候，我哋都有翻嗰個 video。咁係只可以係咁樣咯嚇。
Yeah, and also, I mean, we're sitting together because of that here, right? I mean, this is part of our.Of the way of bringing part of Venice and so on back to Hong Kong. But also, I mean, as Keith said, sometimes one has to travel to see artworks, and sometimes one has to at least go to Guangzhou, or at least go to Macau, or go to Singapore to see a biennial. I know it is a far way to Venice, but the first years in Venice, sure, now I'm in a very privileged situation. I get paid to go there. But in the first years, I was sleeping in some subterranes on mattresses. It was the dirtiest place I ever slept in. But it's, you know, but then you just get yourself into these parties and smuggle yourself in. Nobody had a ticket at that time. And it's part of, I think you also have to, it is important to move. Thank you, yeah. To get water, exactly. Sometimes you have to get up to get water. Sometimes you have to go to Venice or to Biennial and so on. And you cannot just sit here and say, oh yeah, I want to have it all brought here. Nice, but it is, you know, it is a world nowadays where airplanes are very cheap and everybody really can go sometimes and travel a little bit. I'm sorry to be so.
有冇其他問題？
呢邊有兩個問題。
No.
Thank you very much for taking time out to speak to us. It's quite amazing to see so many different generations of Venice curators talking about what they did. this is really quite big. But a little observation of how we are speaking about curating in Venice and Venice Biennale as somewhere that is kind of far away, a slightly whimsical, decadent place. My question for the curators would be, you know, do you curate in a Venice mode and then do you come back to Hong Kong and curate in another mode? How do you negotiate these two ways of curating and, you know, and I guess, you know, Keith also touched upon a little that how curate or being part of Venice has affected your practice afterwards. Then my question for Tobias and Sabrina would be, how has curating in Venice affected your practice afterwards?
Is that me? I'm not so sure about the generations, but okay. Curating has always to do with the space and the time. And even when I curated for Parasite, it was different if I curated in the Parasite space or if I curated in the Shangwan Civic Center. It is also different if you do a one-man show and a different, you know, or a group show or something. I mean, that is what curators do. They are very specific, know what kind of work an artist fits at what place, at what time. And that I think, is the quality of curators to do it. And certainly if you go to Venice, this is you're on hyper mood because it is the biggest, most important exhibition and all your colleagues come, or the artists are much more nervous than before, which a lot of times you see I don't think it happened in the Hong Kong case, but in a lot of times you see amazing artists completely failing in Venice because they get so nervous and so tight about it that they have to bring that amazing work to Venice, and it doesn't work. And Venice is something special, sure, and it makes it's something special more for the artist, for the curator, for the whole team. I think that's just part of the job. Sometimes you curate, you know, as you curate in Venice, and sometimes you do a small group show in the middle of nowhere, and then you do your space in Hong Kong or in Korea. That's the beauty about that job. So I think it's just you have to. That's part of the quality of a curator.
I 即係 physically 一定係會有唔同，就係頭先問題講到嗰個 mode， 咁其實嗰個係牽涉到嗰個理念嘅理念，喺我自己嚟講係冇變嘅，即係去到邊度都會係咁踢街波就踢街波。另外一樣想講嘅就係、譬如另外一次蛙王嗰次，因為我哋嗰個 team 裏邊有三個 curators， 所以我哋分工就好清楚嘅。譬如我對蛙王嘅作品好熟悉嘅，咁我亦都係即係知道自己今次呢個角色咧，就係從一個比較學術啲嘅角度去向外邊介紹蛙王嘅作品嘅重要性嘅。咁我做好呢個角色就得㗎啦。咁喺個分工上就會有呢啲好清楚嘅嘢。好啦，至於場地啊、佈置啊各樣嗰啲咧，就由另外一個 team members 去處理咯。咁所以呢個一定會有某程度上的調節嘅，其實會。
我個同意之前啊 Tobias 啦，同埋 Keith 講啦，根本as a curator， 你本身你有一個自己一路有一個 angle 啦，咁但係咧，亦都係每一個地方啦，都會影響咗你嘅決定啊，點樣去處理啊咁樣樣，所以又唔可能話有唔同嘅 mode， 但係咧就肯定係你，就算你唔好講喺譬如喺沙田同喺香港大學咁做展覽都唔同嘅，咁其實。我覺得佢反而咧就係我 curious 係等咗展覽藝術家喺嗰個環境度做咗一個展覽之後個發展啊，一路 develop 啊，會唔會對佢哋嘅影響會再有趣啲咧？咁依個反而係我即係做每一個展覽我都係好希望見到嘅咧，就係、是、每一個展覽可以帶到一個 artist 一啲 energy 咧，我哋係平時或者唔係佢一般會做到嘅嘢，咁而喺佢出依個展覽嘅時候佢。有啲 push 俾佢，做到佢另外一個 level， 咁又變咗去到另外一個platform 裏邊啦。咁呢個我覺得有趣，然後跟住佢哋會點啦，咁落去睇嚇。
我補充一點先，其實係澄清一點，喺 Palace Collective 嗰次咧，其實我唔係 curator 嚟嘅，我哋係因為係一個 collective， 所以係一個 teamwork 嚟嘅。只不過寫 proposal 嗰個係我，即係簽名我。即係咩飛嗰個係我，所以即係出嚟講嘢嗰個又係我，所以好似係 curator， 其實唔係。咁所以咧，我寫好個 proposal 之後，跟住我哋真係開工做嘢嘅時候，99.幾% 嘅做嘅嘢係其他成員做，唔係我做。所以嗰個 mode 可能呢個係另外一種嚟嘅。
唔該，其實想反而追溯翻了解一下之前咧嗰、那個每一屆嗰個承接嗰個個過程係點樣？因為其實頭先都講可能係一個培養 curator 或者培養 artist 一個 platform， 好 specific 咁啊。嗱請問咧，你哋當時有冇一啲 platform 好 official 或者好容易俾你哋去到 access 同翻之前嗰屆嘅 curator 或者 artist 去分享翻佢哋嗰個經驗啊？於是令到可以帶俾你一啲更加充足的知識啦，去到你 curate 你當時嗰個展覽，有冇咁嘅渠道咧？請
嗱，我覺得你講依個係好重要嘅問題。其實因為 ADC 開始嘅時候，因為我嗰陣時個即係 plan 威尼斯雙年展嘅時候，我係當時喺 ADC 裏邊喺個 visual arts 個 committee 裏邊嘅。咁、那個 whole idea 咧就希望帶出香港一啲年輕嘅 curator， 咁希望一屆咁樣可以做即係累積一啲嘢出嚟。但係個問題咧就係、是。每一屆由第一屆開始咧，啲 curator 都係自己獨立嘅。咁 ADC 嘅角色係 幫助佢嘅。咁但係 ADC 本身我哋都要知道佢哋係個 grand giving 嘅 party， 佢哋唔係 art administrator 嚟嘅。點就嚟講，即係佢唔係 museum。咁其實我哋當時都好多聲音都覺得咧，或者應該同一個 museum 一齊夾啦，即係好似台灣館咁樣。咁你變咗有一堆有成。就會 build up 一啲 audience， 不過好多累積好多經驗啊，各方面嘅嘢。你譬如 invitation list 咁嚟講，你都係噶。你一每年有新嘅，你應該一路加。但係我就即係覺得，起碼到我嗰屆咧，我哋都問嘅，咁佢哋都係冇嘅，即係都未有做得好完善，因為佢哋亦都好忙。佢哋譬如幫你做咗依一屆，佢係幫你做嘅啫，即係佢哋唔係話累積喺度好多嘢喺度，佢哋根本冇咁嘅可能性，都冇咁 manpower 去做依樣嘢。咁所以我哋後來我哋自己喺我嗰屆咧，我哋就有個 mailing list， 咁就後來到下一屆咧，我記得我將個 mailing 我哋請埋曬依啲人曾經嚟過對我哋香港 artist 有興趣嘅，我俾埋個 list 你啦。咁又其實有好多人 email 我哋問好多關於香港 artist 嘅資料嘅。咁所以其實即係如果可以將來個譬如啊同 Empress 個 mo 係一個即係。下以後的一個發展，我覺得這個是很重要的，你變了可以 build up 到很多，即是才會有一些經驗可以累積到出來。
But again, it's far from given that we are doing that again. It was a one-time time trial. Now it has to be re-evaluated. But you are exactly right. This is one of the biggest problems in Hong Kong. If there is no official way to giving it over from one person to another. Luckily, Hong Kong is a small place, and we all know each other and talk to each other, and we also wrote about it. I did a very lengthy article in Kurt's Hong Kong annual yearbook. Actually, when I wrote the article, I was in Korea and I never thought I would come back. So I was rather maybe a little bit more honest than I should have been. But it is a problem and it's not solved yet. And what can we say?
不過咧，以我所知咧，即係 ADC 嗰個申請嗰個過程咧，每一年都會調。即係條條嘅，即係以之前嗰一年嗰個經驗都會影響，即係跟住嚟嗰啲 application process 或者係點樣個諗法。
我就因為我第一年學習小組嘅時候咧，學習啊嘛，學習完翻嚟就要寫報告，就提議咗好多呢啲好有建設性嘅啊。咁後來先發覺個其實個世界唔係咁樣嘅，即係我哋坐喺度冷氣房裏邊諗嘅時候就諗呢種世界噶嘛。咁正如曹花係講，香港勝在就係細啊嘛，藝術圈更加細，係咪？你要攞資料，你係可以直接問上一屆嗰啲人攞嘅。咁即係個世界係咁噶嘛，你同慣傾偈啲人，你就成日同佢傾偈，仲就會容啲攞資料。你唔同佢傾偈啲，你就成日唔同佢傾偈，咁你就係。好難攞資料咁，呢個先係個現實嚟嘅，所以嗰個現實唔係某一個政府部門啊，或者 Empress 或者啲事務去處理到嘅。而家放咗而家世界啲資訊流通到咁樣，周地都係嘅話咧，唔係好大嘅一個問題嚟嘅，我覺得。
我就想而家休息幾分鐘，咁陣間仲有機會問問題，我哋就跟住就會邀請啲藝術家上嚟同我哋分享佢哋個經驗，咁或者休息幾分鐘，唔該。因為好多字我要逐個咁樣讀，咁就唔想嘥時間，因為我哋下一橛咧即係比較多人，咁我先介紹何兆基，咁佢係浸會大學。視覺藝術院副教授，參加過很多國際展覽，包括代表香港參加第23屆São Paulo的雙年展，他又攞過美國亞洲文化協會嘅fellowship， 意大利Civitella Raniera Center 同埋香港藝術發展局嘅獎藝術獎。 咁佢嘅作品咧就以自己身體感官自覺開始，咁佢透過唔同視覺無界如雕塑裝置攝影啊同埋錄像等等就呈現佢啲作品。咁佢希望係以藝術就將自己咧 self and other 就做一個溝通。何小基，跟住咧就 Alan Powell， 咁佢就啲工作就涉及電影，大家都好熟嘅電影策展、藝術藝評、研究，咁又研究亞洲新媒體藝術動向，佢啲錄影作品啦，同埋錄像裝置咧，就以好多。電影節同埋藝術雙年展展出過。喺1986年，佢同黃志輝、馮美華同埋毛敏如就合辦 Videotage 錄影太奇。咁佢哋希望就喺透過 Videotage 咧，就無體藝術界就可以就集結有一個集結點，同埋係提供一個藝術創作同埋文化交流一個平台。佢又創辦這個微波國際無體新無體藝術界 Microwave International New Media Art Festival。你唔好介意我啲中文咁甩咳，好尷尬啊！他又做 Interact Arts 的藝術顧問，不好意思。跟住落去，曾德平我不再介紹啦，佢陣間都要再上嚟嘅。陳玉強，陳玉強是中文大學藝術系教授，咁主講西方無界創作課程。他又是藝術文化碩士創作課程的總監，他參加超過80個展覽，包括第二屆亞太三年展，即是 Asia Pacific Triennial。 他的作品就拿過他大埔中央公園的 project 就拿了公共藝術比賽首獎，佢而多年香港藝術，頭先啊 Tobias 提過，香港視覺藝術年鑑嘅總編，城市藝方個藝術總監，佢而家就幫 AAA 同埋 Yale China Association 做一個顧問，佢研究香港藝術混合。混合無界同埋公共藝術 Map Office， 你冇介意我用英文。Map Office is a multidisciplinary platform devised by Laurent Gutierrez and Valerie Portefeuille. This duo of artists and architects has been based in Hong Kong since 1996, working on physical and imaginary territories using varied means and of expression, including drawing, photography, video, installations, performance, and literary and theoretical texts. Their entire project forms a critique of spatio-temporal anomalies and documents how human beings subvert and appropriate space. Humor, games, and fiction are also part of their approach in the form of small publications providing a further format for disseminating their work. Their cross-disciplinary practice has been the subject of a monograph, Map Office, where the map is the territory. Hiram, 你唔想聽我啲中文啊？Hiram 喺香港出世啦。He's exhibited and curated internationally with his works acquired for the collections of the National Gallery of Australia, Sydney's Powerhouse Museum, and the Queensland Art Gallery. Hiram was invited to London's Camden Arts Centre and Institute for International Visual Arts to mount a one-person exhibition in 1994, while in 2002, the Winnipeg Art Gallery
held a survey of his installations. He's worked as an art and features writer for Hong Kong South China Morning Post and The Standard, and has for the past decade also developed a career in media communications. Hua Wong, 多媒體畫家，咁佢我都係用英文，唔好意思 ，sorry 你見我咁辛苦。He's a multimedia artist who's produced numerous performances, sculptures, paintings, and installations at over 3,000 art events around the world since 1967. He started the Frog King Kwok Museum project in 2001, and his ongoing projects include 9 million works, 900 萬件作品計劃, One Second Performance, 一秒鐘人體裝置, and Frog Fun Lam, 蛙雲林, 同埋Yum Dimension is 任之源, to experience life is frog and art is frog. His works are in local and overseas museums and private collections, and he's been awarded numerous awards by the Urban Council Fine Arts in Sculpture and Mixed Media, and Best Community Arts from City Hall, New York in 1987. In 1998, he was awarded the Emeritus Fellowship by the Hong Kong Arts Development Council, Hong Kong 藝發局視覺成就獎, and Documentaries of Chinese Performance Art from the Macau Museum of Art in 2005. I'd like to welcome the artist on stage. Sorry for the awful introduction. Please, please come and join us for the presentations.首先請何兆基同埋阿 Alan 介紹。
哦，開始啦。
係啊。何兆基。
係，我係何兆基。多謝Tina你咁努力用中文介紹我哋。2001年，原來距離而家12年啦。好似好耐以前嘅歷史事件咁樣。咁不過都好好嘅，即係今日有機會再回顧一下12年前嘅一啲 experience。咁頭先Tina都介紹咧，我嘅作品就比較多係同身體有關，特別係自己嘅身體。從一個所謂 perceptual experience， 即係個知覺經驗嘅角度去睇身體同環境同世界同其他人嘅關係咁。咁2001年個威尼斯商業展咧，我就展出咗三件作品，其中第一件咧就係五把扶手同埋一個進化嘅身體咁。咁啊包括咗有一啲 sculpture 啦，即係嗰五個扶手啦，一路傾斜咁樣樣，同埋後邊一個 series 五張嘅相，就係我扶住嗰五把唔同高度嘅扶手，由一個好低嘅高度一路攀升到一個我幾乎都攀唔到嘅高度咁樣。咁呢個係第一件作品。咁第二件咧就係仲有冇第二張 slide 嘅？係第二件咧就係呢一個啦，呢個啦啊呢度兩件啦，其實一個係 body memory 啦 ，body memory 咧其實就係一個 projection 嚟嘅。個 projection 就係大家見到左手邊嗰、那個。嗰、那個相咧，其實已經係見到兩件作品嘅啦。喺左手邊嗰張相嘅右半邊咧，見到有一個掛喺空中嘅好似浮遊緊嘅影像啦。其實就係一片半透明嘅 acrylic 嘅膠片。咁嗰塊膠片上邊咧就用啲紅色嘅 tape 就貼咗一個交叉啦。咁然之後 project 上去嗰個 video 啦，就係、是。一路重複做緊同一個動作嘅啫，嗰個動作咧就係蒙住眼，然之後就想像個手指指住一個中間點，然後打一個交叉，然後再指一個中間點，再打一個交叉，咁一路重複嘅啫一個 video。咁其實我拍個 video 嘅時候咧，就冇一個紅色嘅交叉喺我前邊嘅，就係想像佢喺我前邊嘅空間嘅某一個位置，然之後希望每次我合埋眼點嘅時候咧。都點中同一個點，同埋畫正嗰個交叉嘅位置。 咁啊，要判斷我係咪成功咧，就唯有係當個 video project 落去一個有紅色交叉嘅 screen 嗰度嘅時候，先至判斷到我係咪成功。咁個經驗就係開始嘅時候係唔係好準嘅，但係咧就越嚟越準。咁我都解釋唔到點解啦，但係我覺得係一件有趣嘅經驗，而嗰件事對我嚟講係一啲身體藉住佢嘅本身嘅記憶去重複一件事嘅一個經驗。咁同樣左手邊嗰個 image 嘅右半部啦，其實就已經係另外一件 work 㗎啦，就有一個差不多都有三米以上高嘅一個 printout， 就係我個側面。咁然之後咧，即係裏邊顯示咗一啲 proportion 啦，個 proportion 就係我個頭同我全身嘅比例。而轉咗過去後邊咧，其實就係有一間房間咗做緊一個 projection。個 projection 咧就係大家見到右手邊嗰個 image 啦，就係 close up 咁樣影住我用個錘仔一路揼一條金條。咁呢一件事咧喺嗰個威尼斯雙人展嘅 opening 嘅時候咧，我都係現場做緊一個 performance 嘅。咁因為嗰陣時係好多人噶嘛，你知道開幕嘅時候，咁我又唔係好知點樣應酬啊咁樣啦。咁就喺嗰個時間就好專心咁做咗呢個 performance 啦，亦都唔知道側邊有啲咩人睇啊咁樣。咁但係我係應該做咗大概8个钟头左右嘅。咁就將一條原本係我頭嘅高度嘅金條，即係真金啦嚇。因為金有一個特性啦，作為一個 material， 即係當你一路加熱去除佢嘅時候咧，佢個金屬係會延展嘅。咁去到最後8个钟头左右啦，就原本由我頭嘅高度咧，就揼到成為我全身嘅高度。咁中間我聽到好多人喺側邊咁樣啦，即係開幕嘅時候都幾多人嘅，但係我就冇乜理到啦。咁好專心咁做咗呢樣嘢。咁稍微介紹一下嗰件作品咧，夠5分钟未啊？我反而想講下咧，喺成個參與威尼斯雙人展嘅經驗咧，其實都幾特別嘅，因為嗰陣時係第一屆啦。大家都充滿期望啦，包括成個香港藝術界，包括啲藝術家。咁當然跟住都仲有好多聲音啦，點解係揀呢個 curator 啊？點解呢幾個 artist 啊？咁樣咁，但係呢啲每年重複都出現㗎啦，大家都已經習慣咗㗎啦。不過喺臨出發嘅時候咧，有一樣嘢我特別記得嘅啫。就係ADC 啦，就作為一個主辦嘅單位啦，臨出發之前就有個 briefing 啦，咁啊叫啲 artist 上去就講下大家要出發啊咁。我其實唔係好記得嗰個 briefing 佢哋講乜，我淨係記得一樣嘢。嗰個當時有一位 ADC 嘅高層咧就話：大家咧代表香港出去啊，一啲關於香港嘅資料咧，大家都留意一下喎。譬如香港人口有幾多啊，香港面積有幾大啊咁。咁我就死啦，咁我唔識嗰啲噶嘛，又唔記得咁。咁我就開始知道了，哇！原來我哋係出去代表香港去做一個親善大使嘅咁。咁即係呢件事都困擾咗我好耐啦。第一就喺我創作裏邊咧，我從來都冇考慮我係咪代表香港。第二就係當去到一個咁樣嘅所謂國際藝術平台嘅時候，點樣去突顯你作為香港人或者香港藝術嘅代表嘅身份咧？我到到而家咧都係搞唔掂嘅，我亦都傾向唔去諗啦。因為即係你喺一個地方成長，你一路形成你對自己藝術嘅一啲睇法，其實我覺得已經包含咗一啲香港賦予俾你嘅嘢。我就有啲困難啦，要好著意咁樣喺呢啲所謂國際平台去突顯自己一個香港藝術家。咁啊，講咗咁多，
多謝而家請阿 Alan。
咁我諗好似嚇 OK 我係應該有兩個作品喺12年前嗰個威尼斯雙影展嗰度。咁咧兩個作品都應該係叫做循環影院，一個就係即係 one channel 嘅 video， 另外一個咧就係一個installation 咯。諗 installation 因為實在太暗，因為當時嚟講我哋啲 video projector 其實都比較弱雞啲嘅，即係可能只係得幾耐400 lux 啊，唔係冇400添，可能得200 lux 咁，所以係真係差唔多黑掹掹咁樣。你同埋我哋嘅相機亦都未必會影到，因為嗰個 image 係喐緊。咁我講咗呢個先。其實recycling cinema 係有一個12分鐘嘅 version。咁我為咗威尼斯 都係因為即係 Sabrina 咁講啦，即係啲人嚟睇其實係唔會睇十二分鐘嘅，咁佢可能睇一分鐘就走啦咁。咁我都諗過嚇，咁點想可以將十二分鐘剪一分鐘，其實都冇乜可能噶啦。咁我就扣到盡咧，都係扣到得翻七分鐘。咁咧但係其實成個概念咧，其實就係嚟自好簡單。即係如果有拍嘢嘅人，我諗都知道咧。其實咧喺套電影裏邊咧，你係唔會揾到一個鏡頭係由左邊去右邊，然後繼續由右邊去翻左邊，左邊去右邊，成七分鐘都係咁樣嘅，即係唔會有呢一樣嘢出現。咁我就喺度諗，其實呢一種嘅電影語言，呢、這個不停咁 continuous 咁 pan 嘅電影語言，除咗喺嗰啲譬如電譬如啲公眾場所嗰度會有一啲 surveillance camera， 佢係會不停咁喺度咁。即係監察住大家嘅時候，會咁樣左右咁望之外咧，好似就冇其他嘅地方會有呢樣嘢。咁所以我就諗，其實有冇可能係呢一種咁 mechanical 嘅電影嘅 movement 上邊，我可以做到一個 language 出嚟咧，即係可以講到一啲好 human 嘅嘢咧。咁我就由嗰個開始去問呢個問題咧，就做咗呢個作品。咁我都其實講唔到呢個作品係點，因為實在好難講一個即係 time base 嘅作品俾大家聽。咁下個月有機會可以去睇到嘅，買個廣告。咁有興趣嘅可以問我哋喺邊度啦，唔買得咁明啦。係啊，何生嘅作品都有機會睇到嘅，係咩？下個月唔係下個月咩？係啊係啊，好係啊係啊係啊，咁啱下個月都可以再睇翻。咁insulation 嗰個就再將嗰個左右嗰個 pan 嗰樣嘢就又係放翻落個身體度。咁我就係用一個薄嘅紙去做。咁當時點解會用個薄嘅紙就係、是因為始終我影嘅其實係油街，我喺油街藝術村嗰度影嘅嗰個呢、這個 highway。咁油街藝術村亦都係即係我覺得係一個好重要喺。在我第一次即成立了錄影泰奇之後，第一次有自己錄影泰奇的 office， 我們終於可以有一個自己的即有 staff 有 office 的地方那裡做事。也都由街望出去那個東區走廊是非常之吸引，所以就做了這個 work 啦。個 installation 的版本其實就是諗緊點樣可以 present 一個 landscape， 一個 moving 的 landscape。 咁我哋講 landscape 通常就有啲 landscape painting， 通常都係啲 panoramic 嘅長嘅紙，咪長即係長島咁樣。咁所以就用咗一個咁嘅島去做一個咁嘅 installation。 咁都如果係做得成嘅話，又下個月都有得再睇翻，咁啱咁咯嚇。咁我諗我用唔曬啲時間去 pass 俾
多謝。陳宇，
我OK。紅白藍《西遊記》咧，我已經唔記得咗點解有呢、這個有呢個名嘅。不過咧，就呢、這個我仲記得個時間咧，我哋嗰屆咧係非常非常之短。我記得咧，我哋好似開過一次會咧，即係 Sabrina 你 remind 我啦，就係開第一次會咧就已經決定咗有個咁嘅 theme， 然後跟住翻屋企一個禮拜內做功課，即係話你會做啲咩嘢，然後跟住咧下個禮拜就揾人咧係做個 model 出嚟，然後咧就俾遞上去俾藝展局你要批嘅啦。咁即係話咧，我哋嘅諗法咧係非常非常唔成熟嘅。咁好彩佢揾咗兩個都係快槍手啦。咁 Stanley 係好忙嘅人，就做嘢做得好快。咁我係嗰啲要有問題先會有答案嘅人，即係話我自己係唔會無啦啦會做作品嘅人嚟嘅。咁 OK， 咁啊《紅白藍》咁唔係《紅白藍》《西遊記》《西遊記》嚇。咁然後咧就Stanley 咧就嘅。對於呢個主題嘅反應咧，佢就係做咗個 tea house 啦，咁佢就發覺 Marco Polo 嚟中國嘅時候冇提到茶呢樣嘢，咁今次就將茶帶翻去嗰個威尼斯嗰度。我自己咧就其實就真係唔知應該做啲咩嘢，但係嗰段時間咧，我記得我自己嘅興趣咧就係想做一啲 research based art 嚇，呢樣嘢我通常比較少做。第二樣嘢，我對 architecture 嗰個興趣好大嘅，喺嗰段時間啊，咁所以咧我就做咗啲 research 關於威尼斯究竟係咩地方。 咁威尼斯對我嚟講一個，即係我做咗一件作品係關於威尼斯嗰個嘅個地景啊、個地貌啊嘅嘅作品嘅。咁呢個地貌咧，我諗最令我感興趣咧，就係呢個城市咧，係每年都沉緊啊，即係因為佢沉降啊，佢底下嗰啲木啊同埋嗰啲淤泥咧開始鬆啊，開始沉降。咁當然威尼斯而家都做緊啲補救方法。咁沉緊嘅城市，我覺得好正咯嚇，因為大家都知道嗰啲 Atlantic 啊，嗰啲所謂啊好多傳言咧，講一啲總之最正嘅城市咧，最後都係沉咗落海底，而你揾唔到嘅咁樣。咁我就由呢個意象出發，但係由呢個意象出發，我冇辦法做到一個沉嘅城市。於是咧，我選擇咧係反轉佢，即係話將威尼斯嗰個地圖做出發點，又反轉佢。咁當然我做咗好多 analysis， 包括呢個城市係點樣去被建立嘅啦？啊，開始嘅時候有啲柱，然後柱同埋柱之間有橋，有橋之後咧先會有陸地，有陸地然後先至就會有井，有井於是有廣場，有廣場先有 brick block， 諸如此類嘅一啲嘅研究。簡單嚟講咧，就我做咗啲咩嘢咧？我做咗一樣嘢就係將嗰個地景調轉。調轉咗之後咧，發生啲咩事咧？就係我亦都係好同意正話有啲講者講威尼斯今日嘅威尼斯，其實佢嗰個一個作為一個地方嘅一個內容咧，其實已經消失咗，因為佢以前係一個軍事地方，佢以前係一個嗰啲好有錢嘅人喺度建立 palace 嘅個地方，但係今日係變成 shopping mall 咯，基本上。OK， 兩分鐘，咁啊。咁我於是我就即係倒，即係做啲紙袋，將啲嘢倒曬，即係呢個掏空嘅紙袋向下倒。而上邊咧就係、是、一片我自己所想像嘅，睇到一個水底嘅一個希望，俾到一種咁嘅感覺嗰啲觀眾。喺呢件作品嚟講，我覺得我自己係做得未夠盡嘅。最主要原因就因為嗰個控制唔到嗰啲光同埋嗰個面嗰啲嗰個所謂銀色嘅啲反光咧，嗰個光度咧去唔到我自己腰嘅要求。咁不過有一樣嘢咧，就正話講到都提到咧，就話嗰個上屆同埋下屆之間嘅溝通咧，其實我哋有接收到嘅就係話上一屆咧就即係警告我哋話，千祈唔好依賴嗰度嘅工人同埋嘅 supplies。如果你要一粒螺絲嘅話，唔該你帶埋去。咁於是我哋咧帶咗成個 team 去。咁都好彩，我哋四日內起咗一件我暫時嚟講係最巨型嘅作品咯。啊，咁呢度都要多謝有呢個咁嘅機會嘅，因為我近年咧其實嗰個興趣咧喺創作藝術嘅興趣已經開始 shift 去其他嘅領域。威尼斯呢個履歷咧係 keep 住我，嗰啲人仲 recognize 我係個 artist。嘅一個好重要嘅一項咯，叫做咁啊，將來有冇用我唔知啊。總之，如果你話啊，你有啲機會啊，陳友強唔知做啲咩嘅時候，最後話我佢都曾經係一個 artist 咯。OK， 係咁先，係跟住。
Hello, good afternoon. Maybe first.Few words. I mean, unfortunately, it happens that Norman could not be present in the museum today. But then also this kind of topic, I think it was very interesting to Hong Kong and Venice from a space museum perspective. I think we could not find better place, M+, for this discussion this afternoon. Also, maybe I should say that before being part of a Hong Kong pavilion in 2007, we already participated twice in Venice Biennale, in 2000 in the Architecture International Pavilion, and in 2003 in the Utopia Station, part of the international section. So we knew that somehow Venice is a kind of beast, as everybody described it before. It's not a museum condition, your work can be flooded, any kind of storm or whatever crazy situation can happen there, I think it happened to everyone. It's part of the experience of Venice. So maybe I should, the starting point of this project, which somehow happened in three parts. first in Hong Kong, then in China, Venice, and then in China. When we were asked by the curator, by Norman, to represent Hong Kong, we had quite difficulty to imagine ourselves in a kind of nationalistic approach of a pavilion, which is really much 19th century, very still colonial way of thinking about the world. And at that time, also, we were spending most of our time, working time, discussion time in China, in islands of China or in Beijing. And to be part of Hong Kong at some point was interesting, but to be part of China was for us an even bigger challenge. So we started here from another crazy environment in Lofosan, in the northern part of Hong Kong, with a land that we did a lot of projects, but especially our first installation project in 1999, reclaiming 1 square meter of land, throwing oyster shells in the sea. Maybe thinking like this map indicates that if everybody does that, maybe we can build a bridge to go to China. So when we started with Hong Kong Pavilion, again, this idea of flooding and creating micro environments, also something that would stand out. As everybody said, it's very hard when you see hundreds of work every day to pop out of a mass of other works. By location, best location facing Arsenal Alley, this open door could open on this magic Hong Kong island made with 2 tons of oyster shells and with 16 talking parrots, talking in Italian, French, English, Putonghua, and Guangdonghua. Talking to the audience and also being missed by those little misting system, creating another kind of very humid microenvironment in the heat of the summer of Venice, adding more humidity to this very humid city. Then the second part, which was really where we spent most of the time working on, is these 2 posters, Hong Kong is in Venice, Map Office is in China, and having this 2-part installation, removing the less important, which is Venice and Map Office, basically you land with Hong Kong is in China. So to go to China, at that time, there was 1 obvious possibility, which was to respond a show curated by Johnson Chan in Shanghai called Reversing Horizon. Again, looking at Hong Kong from China's perspective, where we presented those 2 posters and a video installation with a trolley and a parrot.
Yeah, as Valerie said, our production was made in 2 parts. One was an island made out of oyster shell, inhabited by parrots, and the other part was basically a trolley, a traditional tool that we see in Hong Kong street, with a piece of marble, 1 square meter of land, with some writing on it called Personal Island. And basically on the day of the opening and to commemorate the 10 years anniversary of Hong Kong to China, we basically decided to offer this 1 square monument, Personal Island, to China, but not China in China, but China in Venice. Then obviously this was with the idea of addressing borders and question of borders and nationalities and identities, which was still a question at that time. What we did is basically on the day of the opening, we had the parrot and myself put the piece of marble and try to cross the border. The border that we had to cross first was the Italian border, which was basically the entrance of the Arsenal. And you have to imagine the conversation with the Italian gateway asking, but no, you cannot bring your piece to China because you belongs to Hong Kong. And we're saying, but Hong Kong belongs to China today. And a kind of absurd situation, discussion.
Yeah, assuming that many European people think that Hong Kong is in Japan.
And but finally, after two attempts, we could cross it, and basically we crossed the 1.2 kilometers distance between Hong Kong and China pavilion in Venice, crossing Africa and so on, and arrive in the garden, the backhand garden, and held by, I think was a PLA boy, by Chofei, we basically put our monument, personal island, under the cherry trees, and it remains for the whole duration of the Biennale. And what happened is basically at that time, and that was really the important aspect of our intervention, is that yes, we could represent Hong Kong, but there is something beyond the national identity. There is how do artists reflect on the world they are living in? And at that time, Chofei was doing personal pavilion, and we kind of meet and have discussion between personal island and personal pavilion.
All right, I'm just gonna talk about I Love Your Mother, My Own Death, which is the work I did for Star Ferry. And but before I'll go on to that, I'm just gonna go and track back to first to 2009 and then to 1963 before this work. So anyway, I'm gonna do it really quickly, so excuse me if you're missing anything. You can always ask me questions later. Okay, so in 2009, I actually wrote a review for the 53rd Venice Biennale for the journal Sea for Culture, 这个是文化现场. And so I'm actually gonna show you a little bit of the revised excerpt from Excuses for Bad Behavior, which was the name of the article, because it actually, in a way, very much frames the work that I did in Venice in 2007, but also my current interest in contemporary art as a prop, as in movie prop. Okay. So this is the flyer for 含淚的玫瑰, which is a film directed by Choi Yun in 1963. Love in Roses, or alternative known as Tear Laden Rose or Rose in Tears. So there's actually the movie flyer from 1963 that if you go to the cinemas back then, they actually distribute that to you for free. And I'm sort of put the text up so you can actually read it, it's probably easier. So in 2009, a number of weeks before I actually wrote a review, I stumbled across the film Love and Tears, a rarely screened early 1960s Hong Kong movie playing on television. The film, which starred Lam Hong, Wu Feng, and Zai Yin, three of Hong Kong's very well-known actors, was one of those cult films famed for its central prop, a painting of Lam Hong, flanked by a huge rose, complete with designer fonts of the film title, all of which was rendered in a commercial art style popular in the era. The film was centered around two painter friends competing for the love of one woman. Zai Yin plays Cao Ba, an artist whose star career took off, while Wu Feng, who portrayed Ling Han, was down in the dumps, ignored by the elite art establishment. So I've actually seen this film before many over the years, but only with very vague recollections. And but it was actually something that caught my eye, actually, this last time I saw it back then. Later in the movie was the scene in which an art selection committee was choosing a dozen works for the overseas Million Nations Art Show, Man Gokzi, in her show, a veiled reference for the Venice Biennale. Despite the recognition of Ling Han's talent by the panel, his painting of the tearful rose was ousted because there were only enough places by those members present on the panel. Meanwhile, Cao Ba was incensed by this injustice and decided to remove his own work in order to have Ling Han the opportunity to participate. Ling Han's work earned him acclaim at the international show, enabling his relocation to Rome as a celebrated artist afterwards. So I just want to show you the detail so you can actually see the painting there on the left-hand side. But also want to bring to you the attention on the lower right corner there, the actual movie tag. And since we are all in the Google translation age, I'll also translate that into English and Italian for you. But I have to say this is actually with a bit of discrepancy, loss in translation there, but I thought it's actually kind of rather appropriate and interesting. So I'm going to go back to I Love You More Than My Own Death, which is the work that I did for Venice. So the work is essentially about how art becomes what Alfred Hitchcock's called a MacGuffin, a prop that is used to advance the story but has no intrinsic value of its own. Everybody wants to have their hands on a MacGuffin, but then nowhere is it actually says what it is or why it is important. So in that sense, it's actually about the trick of the eye, sleight of hand, or magic, if you like. And I just want to talk about this work that that you can see the images of. So basically, the works can it's made of three parts, actual installation. And there's a number of, there's actually really complicated, very much a story within a story, references within the piece. But basically, it's broken down to three parts. The first part of which is called the pledge, the second part, the turn, and the third part, the prestige. And I've actually, at that time, this work was very much informed by a curator called Christian Lee, who in 1993 did an exhibition called I Love You More Than My Own Death at the Venice Biennale. What was interesting was that Mr. Lee basically disappeared after the show opened. And the work was actually left stranded in Venice for about a decade, bills unpaid. So that was actually, this is actually, and I Love You More Than My Own Death was actually a reference to Pedro Almodóvar as well. So it originally started off as a collaboration between Christian Lee and Pedro Almodóvar. So this is actually a work. So this is the first part, the pledge. And what you see there is actually in that circular mirror shape is actually lenticular, a photographic lenticular transparency where you see the mango, and then as you sort of move, you know, side by side, you actually see the mango actually kind of peeled, and then underneath that, an image of the Red Guards, Mao Zedong's Red Guards in the 1960s, actually at one of China's universities, teaching about the virtues of labor and its return, and basically the mango was the prop that was used. Okay. And the second part here is called the turn, which I've actually made into almost like a magician's Chinese box, or you know, you could call it like an ivory tower with a magic mirror attached. And also within this oval shape there is actually an image of a peach. And factory workers actually producing Dai Zi Bo, big character posters from the Cultural Revolution era. And then we'll go on to the last part, which is called the prestige. And the prestige is actually the pledge, the turn and prestige are actually three parts of that was actually interpreted by in the novel. The prestige about the magician, and this is basically the three parts of a magic trick. And the prestige is the part where you are able to actually produce something extraordinary. And basically, it's like, you know, say for example, out of a handkerchief, and you're able to produce a pigeon out of it. So, and this is actually the last part of which you actually see kind of like a abstract coin or ring, a coin and a ring, and you also see the profile of Chung Ling So, which was a magician from the late 20th century, late 19th century, early 20th century, of a guy called William Robinson, who was a Scottish New Yorker. And he pretended to be a Chinese magician for about 20 years until his death. So, And this is in the so-called response exhibition when it came back to Hong Kong. So I can ask the questions later if anybody's interested. Okay.
Thank you very much. 多謝大家。 我首先想問個問題就有關，都係其實應付翻。 忘記咗啊，王。
I use some English channel and Cantonese channel. First, want to try play the 5 minutes video to give you an idea.
Thank you.
The second, I have some PowerPoint. Just one by one, like a slideshow. Thank you. Can you do it, help out? Just 2 seconds, one image. Yeah. This year, we invited Freeman Lau be the let's say, the designer. Then I have very good help from the Fringe Club and my more respect student, Keith Chang. He is a monk now. So he helped out. So Benny from the Fringe, he has some idea, because in logical thinking. And then the other Wong Sun kid, crazy with the ink and brush culture. And then Keith, all these three curators. So I'm crazy, all together make a mess. Made a mess. So it happened to be like this. Sometime inside, outside, and non-stop playing. Very good help. My wife, she's from Korea. Cho Han Jae, and a great artist. So this one put together the response show, the collage. Opening interview. Hong Kong location, good. We can do indoor and outdoor. The best site. The best portion I like to play. I think finish my communication. Thank you.
多謝。我頭先想問嘅問題，唔好意思。我頭先想問嘅問題就其實再早一啲都掂過嘅，即係喺一件藝術品嘅即係成唔成功嗰個過程啦。即係你哋其實每一個介紹自己嘅作品都介紹得非常之好。咁每一件作品都有自己嘅背景，都有自己嗰個narrative， 或者自己有一個內容。咁喺威尼斯雙年展，或者喺呢啲咁大型嘅國際性嘅展覽裏邊啦，即係個要你嗰件作品咧帶到你要嗰個意思俾個觀眾，即係個 audience reception 呢一個問題。你哋即係點樣？你哋個經驗係點樣？即係喺威尼斯嗰個經驗啦，你覺得有冇啲地方係即係 work 唔 work？ 同埋用咗啲咩方法？當時用咗啲咩方法係可以將你嗰件作品嗰個意思係帶到俾個觀眾？ So my question is about audience reception and each of you introduced your works really well, and with the background story and the concept and the detail behind them. And many of them are in fact quite sort of content heavy and with their own narrative structures. Within the context of, I mean, we talked earlier about the kind of marathon experience of visiting these kind of large exhibitions. How do you deal with the challenge of bridging the gap between the audience and the artwork? And how do you get the substance of your artwork across? I mean, what tactics did you use? Did you have publications or all sorts of, you know, what things did you use? What would you have done differently? Just share a little bit about the experience of the different types of media. I mean, you represent very different types of installations and very different types of artworks, and they all present their own challenges. It would be good to hear how you bridge that gap between the audience and the artwork.
Opening 嗰段時間呢，嚟嘅觀眾呢，其實都係藝術圈裏面嘅人嚟嘅，即係基本上係一班專業嘅人士。我唔係好擔心嗰班專業嘅觀眾唔知我哋做緊啲乜嘅，因為亦都好大機會之前佢已經了解我哋一啲作品。另外一啲就係普通嘅觀眾呢，可能就係開幕之後，佢係慕名去睇威尼斯雙年展，或者係對藝術有興趣嘅觀眾。 但係嗰段時間，往往我哋已經唔喺現場啦。咁變咗，我都幾重視究竟喺個展覽期間嗰啲譬如 catalog 啊，或者相關嘅宣傳嘅物品，佢係對幫助其他觀眾了解嘅作品係好大作用。我記得好似我哋即係因為我嗰個要。
有 operation 嘅，即係有要開關個 projector 啊，諸如此類咁樣。咁所以我記得係我哋要train 當年我哋用嘅咧就係一啲好靚嘅金髮意大利女郎做我哋嘅督嗰啲叫咩？即係導賞係啦。咁我哋咧就要教曉嗰啲金髮女郎咧點樣樣開關嗰啲機啊，同埋講解嗰個作品俾。 啲人聽咯，即係如果未有個係啦，即係未好似之後改咗係香港嘅導賞團導賞員噶嘛，係嘛？跟住我都冇去過，因為<笑>其實你哋當時咧，即係有冇見到啲開咗幕之後，你哋留咗喺威尼斯，有冇留多少少時間，即係真係自己？ 見到啲觀眾喺度同啲展品，即係有冇啲咩反應啊，或者有冇啲咩 feedback
啊？你自己親眼見到？我估即都係喺開幕嗰段時間，譬如一個禮拜之內，我哋都完咗都留多幾日嘅。咁嗰段時間嚟嘅都仲係圈內嘅觀眾嚟嘅。咁偶然間會有啲唔係嘅。咁但係喺嗰啲場合咧，我覺得。 有機會同啲觀眾直接對話係好嘅，咁當然我頭先講嗰啲 catalog 啊，其他啲 publicity 嘅 material 會幫到，即係佢要拎走同佢傾完之後，佢可以多一啲 reference 咁。一般我覺得去得睇嘅啦，其實佢唔會完全無知嘅，不過係咪可以再深入啲咁樣理解，有直接嘅 dialog， 我覺得係有幫助嘅。
我自己覺得所有 artwork 都有啲，其實都有好多唔同嘅 layers 嘅，即係話如果你對住一個對 art 冇乜認識嘅 layman 嚟到去講嘅時候，譬如以我哋嘅情況，咪哦呢個咪 invert 咗嗰一個威尼斯嘅 map 咯，咁簡單到係咁嘅樣。咁阿 Stanley 可能就話啊呢個係 tea house 坐低飲杯茶啦，咁然後睇下風景，即係呢個 enjoyment 可以係簡單到咁咯。 咁如果你話要去到一啲比較深入啲嘅一啲討論咧，老實講，當然啦，即係如果係藝術圈嘅人咧，其實嗰個對於 contemporary art 嘅 tolerance 係好高噶嘛，即係佢會就算唔知佢都會試下用佢嗰套 methodology 去諗一諗。但係呢個 communication 我唔覺得係完全可行嘅，因為。 以我自己為例咧，我成日覺得我自己作品不斷要 develop 啊，即係話當你真係 develop 件作品擺咗個現場嘅時候，其實譬如以我哋嘅 case 就係話有好多嘢要喺去到威尼斯之前咧就已經要決定曬，包括即係帶啲工人去帶啲物料去。咁但係問題咧，去到嗰個 site 嘅時候，我發覺咧嗰件作品咧係有其他嘅可能性嘅，原來即係你同你個 idea 相處得耐啲嘅時候，佢就會有產生啲其他嘅。 嘅東西，而啲東西係同個 site 有關嘅。咁但係去到嘅時候咧，如果你冇一啲相應嘅物料同埋 technical support， 你係唔可以再 push further。 呢個係一個其實都係成日好多時嘅無可奈何嘅狀況咯。即係簡單嚟講就係、是，如果係譬如好似依家以白相傳了為例咧，我諗佢可以 improvise 即刻。就係如果以我一啲比較硬啲嘅一啲所謂叫設計嚟講咧，就相對比較窄落嘅空間。有一樣我都想提出嘅就係話，即係當我哋講觀眾嘅時候。其實以香港有咁細嘅地方，同埋相對嚟講喺 contemporary art 嘅範疇裏邊係較為冇咁顯眼，當時啊冇咁顯眼嘅一個地區嚟計，我哋嘅觀眾好多時咧，即係話對 artist 有用啊，或者係有意思嘅觀眾，好可能係其他地方嘅 artist。多於咧，當然 artist 都好想會認識多啲 curator 嚟到去發展多啲嘅一啲嘅展覽機會都唔定。即係話頭嗰幾個 opening 咧，即係 opening 嗰幾日咧，其實咧係行內人嘅交流，但係亦都好似展銷會嘅，即係展銷會裏邊咧，你又要揾客啦，或者係行內嘅人咧係互相認識啦 ，curator 同埋 curator 互相認識啦 ，curator 揾 artist 啦 ，artist 揾 curator 又揾翻 artist 啦咁樣。咁如果以呢個咁嘅 model 嚟到去考慮一個咁嘅場合嘅時候咧，即係話當我哋講呢個觀眾嘅時候咧，究竟我哋講緊啲乜嘢？即係嗰個 expectation 可能唔係話好緊張，在於你明唔明嗰件 art 咯。我真係會問一個問題：明咗咁咪點啊？定係話明錯咗咁可能仲好喎？即係呢樣嘢咧，一個所謂叫做好完整嘅一個意念嘅一個傳遞咧，其實覺得唔係好緊要啊。因為每個人都有不同的 role 你要設定自己想在那裡拿到什麼。如果以威尼斯為例，我自己的見解呢就是說這個場合呢太大了，大到一個地步呢就是說個個人都想看明星，想看排隊去看那幾個譬如說拿獎那些 work 究竟是怎麼樣，為什麼他會拿到 work， 希望 develop 到一些 strategy 來到去捕捉到當代藝術裏面 最流行或者最有效的乜嘢嘢，可能是一些很功利的一啲嘅諗法。我哋都相信很多，即係話去威尼斯睇展覽，而唔係代表緊任何嘅地區嗰啲所謂叫做同行咧。其實咧，大家去嗰度睇，其實係睇最新的發展同埋嗰個 criteria 係嘅現況係點樣。咁如果喺呢咁嘅場合，咁多人、咁多事件發生、咁多 parties。你老實講，如果你是一個很純粹的參與者，譬如好似 Keith 正話，即係講過佢嗰個參加嘅啲目的，可能真係唔係好大，即係唔係 make 好多 sense 嘅啫。但如果對於唔同嘅身份嘅人咧，佢可能就即係會產生好多價值咯。咁如果相對於一啲其他嘅展覽我參與過嘅咧，我成日會覺得細嘅展覽咧。如果你話同行同埋同行之間嘅交流，同埋你嘅可被見到嘅性，即係話你會唔會被睇得到咧？嗰、那個機會仲大喎、哦！你去到啲咁巨型嘅，即係話行三日都行唔完嘅展覽，你記低一個 artist 嘅名字，你都好難記得低。你點樣講 communication 咧？呢個係一個即係幾即係大盛事重要，但係。是不是真的在 communication 交流或者在一個叫做純粹的交流這個層面真的 workable 呢？我覺得未必是，所以當我們講觀眾的時候，我們可能可以用這些 perspective 去考慮。
I think Kurt is right in addressing the difficulty of contemporary art and its perception, especially for not necessarily extremely knowledgeable audience as we could have after the first few days. In our case, we realize the difficulty of the space because we saw the previous edition when Parasite was in this space already, and we could see the context and also it was the year it was extremely odd. That was 2003. And what we did, basically, the difficulty we had and what we did was basically to make people enter in the pavilion. Because every time we talk about the Hong Kong pavilion, this fantastic location, Tobias talked about it today, we always look at it from the other side. Basically, we look in front, which is Arsenale,
then you exceed the Hong Kong pavilion. You never, the difficulty is to enter. Then what we did is basically, we use a colorful animal, the papagali, the parrots, which is an animal symbol of Venice. The mask, the Venetian mask and everything, is basically the symbol of this kind of effervescent life. And also, we put them in a position that they can be seen from the door, and also we create this kind of atmosphere with misting system where people could, if it's extremely hot, they could come and create a kind of microclimate to come and relax and take a bit of shadow under the vineyards. And then that was the way to. Then the question is first to attract people, and then you have various layers, and that's the beauty of contemporary art. Is basically you start to question yourself, what does that mean? And you have publication, you have material, you have people to help you to understand the artwork and yourself to kind of question what the idea behind and so on.
Yeah, maybe I will just tell a kind of anecdote which I find interesting, since also we are all here. I was in Venice for the opening of Liquid 2 weeks ago, and I met during the opening an Austrian couple who came to me asking me if my daughter's name was Emma, and then I said yes, and said, "Oh, we met your daughter a couple of years ago. She sold us an oyster outside the pavilion to go and buy an ice cream for €2. Very, very clever." And I said, maybe we should meet tomorrow. I want to show you something. And then the next day I met them, and they had a bag, and their bag was full of books of Hong Kong Pavilion. They have a whole collection of all. So I saw the Book of Park, I saw your book. And was very interesting because those books were completely wrong. Like even the names of your artists were either misspelled or title of a show were not there. But basically they portrait every 2 years the Hong Kong pavilions. They basically didn't speak well English at all. Never been to Hong Kong. For them they see Hong Kong through the eyes of the pavilion. But the only thing they keep on repeating in their broken English that it's amazing because each time it is so different. And for them, this difference was the attraction to come again and again and make a book about the Hong Kong pavilion, their personal book, their personal experience. So of course they had photo with the frog and the glasses. And again, this time they were very curious to see what was going on as if the whole Biennale was contained into the Hong Kong pavilion.
Okay. Actually, that year, I went back later on in that year during the film festival as well. But it's really hard to gauge what and who you're communicating. But it was interesting because I actually spent a bit of time in the space during, when the show was out. Even, I have to say, after everybody is gone, including people from the ADC, and I actually end up having to entertain Mr. Timothy Fole because he looked completely lost outside. So that's something that I hope the ADC is a little bit better in that, actually have people there, to look after, people who may drop in, because that year there was absolutely nobody there. But the point being, it's... it's a very informed audience, people who go in Venice to go and visit the Biennale. A lot of them actually go every year. These are maybe not the preview people. They're actually people who kind of goes on holiday and they actually do want to go to see, the Biennale, and they're very seasoned art viewers. And I've actually had, on the preview day, actually somebody came and said to me that, I actually know this show that Christian Lee that was referencing my exhibition, and he was actually telling me how he knew artists who never got the work back. But that's sort of interesting but definitely when I was there, I've actually had every time I go into the space, the girls would be seem to be talking to somebody or somebody would be asking them question. And I don't know if people have the habit of going to spaces and say, oh, this show is wonderful. I don't know whether it's habitual or whatever, but definitely when I went in, you know, like it was interesting because a lot of times that people were kind of very, very, very generous and actually were very complimentary as well. But with the work itself, you know, the work that I did, it was very much strategized for that space in a way that that space was basically derelict. It's a 14th century workshop. Basically, you can't hang anything off the wall. You know, the paint falls off. You know, it crumbles, and it's dusty. You know, we sort of vacuum it, we wash it, and it's still dusty. Anyway, it was a constant struggle, you know, trying to actually have it sort of semi-pristine. So which was what I gathered before we actually did the show. So my strategy at the time was that, you know, what would I put in there that would actually be able to have some sort of a impact within the space. And so I came up with this idea of that because the space was totally, you know, it was dark and grubby and grim. And so what do? You put in the most colorful, the most over the top objects in there. And so which is how I came up with having those Las Vegas type sort of objects in there with these lenticular images and in these sort of bright candy colors. So that was like for me in conceiving the work, that was like a precondition. And then also, what would I do? What would be the image that I need to say what I want to say in order to to communicate, you know, to have some sort of visual impact? So it was like, okay, well, and then it ended up to be these gigantic fruits, which is like kind of the most kind of banal, kitsch, stupid images that, you know, you could think of to have to put in an international art exhibition. So, but then at the same time, it's like, okay, well, if I'm going to put in these fruits, you know, what would they say? What would they mean? What are these fruits? You know, what's the sort of cultural connotations? And so it's basically, and then I kind of at the time, suddenly, that whole Christian Lee reference about the curator who disappeared, that was something that I've had, you know, on my bookshelf for a long time, since the mid-1980s. And so I somehow, by default, you know, I found this story about how he disappeared. And so that in a way, all these elements kind of came together, and then it was like basically building an opera, in a sense. You know, how do I use all these stories and actually weave another narrative to actually say what I want to say? And so it was very, very much like you know, it was, you know, movie making in a way. It was like directorial, trying to put in all these different elements together and actually create a story that kind of crosses time and locations, and in a way, it becomes a very particular, independent, self-contained pavilion of its own. It became, I mean, I sort of look at the three works as almost like a Chinese garden, and yes, actually, somebody complained about the Chinaman with the ponytail on the coin at the time. And saying that, referencing how that was actually how the work was geared towards a Western audience, which I thought was just kind of showed there's actually somebody who a writer here. So I thought just like kind of I thought that was so funny, and it kind of really kind of describes a particular mentality of what people perceive. You know, this kind of quasi sort of political correctness.
Thank you.
我想補充少少關於觀眾咧，其實有三方面我想提。其實咧，每一個藝術家咧，佢第一個要處理觀眾咧，就係佢自己。佢一定係做個作品出嚟，第一個自己睇翻嘛。咁所以頭先啲朋友講嗰啲其他嗰啲觀眾咧， 已經係另外一批觀眾嘅考慮嚟。好啦，咁呢個咧引申落去咧，譬如 Parasite 嗰次參展咧，我哋 Parasite Collective 啊嘛，咁係十幾人係作為一個 artist 啊嘛，咁嗰度又係一個非常之複雜嘅一個過程嚟。咁如果大家記得剛才我哋即係嗰個作品嗰個 image 咧，就係有啲好大嘅 cement 嘅 cylinders， 啲觀眾係可以瞓入去裏邊噶嘛。咁呢個咧其實咧，就可以同蛙王嗰啲作品一齊講嘅，就係個溝通。我哋通常講緊嗰種溝通咧，就係一種智性上或者知識上嘅溝通。講俾嗰個觀眾聽，我作品背後嘅什麼什麼什麼。但係另外一種好最直接嘅同觀眾嘅溝通咧，就係啲感性上嘅溝通。40度行到熱辣辣，行咗幾個鐘頭入到嚟，見到有一個咁涼爽嘅地方，有條柱可以彎身喺度。hea 嘅，咁佢就會 hea 咗落去噶啦。咁或者蛙王叫啲觀眾戴個青蛙眼鏡，佢戴咗呢個面具之後咧，佢其實就喺影相嗰一秒鐘裏邊咧，佢已經得到一個解放。咁呢啲咧係不能夠用言語去慢慢去 articulate 嘅一啲溝通嘅好深層嘅嘢嚟嘅。咁視覺藝術其實嗰個犀利地方應該係呢一方面。我想補充啲三樣嘢，多謝。
多謝你。其實我都想回應翻少少頭先啊，佢提過嗰樣嘢，就個 network 幾緊要。即係你好多時你喺威尼斯，你遇到啲嘢唔係你刻意去揾嘅，即係你係撞到啲人啊，或者係人哋講俾你聽係有力仲有邊度有啲好嘢睇啊，各樣嘢。咁呢個都係一個好。即係好重要一個經驗喺威尼斯個經驗，因為時間關係咧，我就唔再問問題啦，就希望你哋有啲問題想問我哋啲畫家。個個都攰啊！哦。
Hi, thank you all for coming here on your weekend. What Keith had said earlier about, you know, just trying to put together the pavilion based on sort of, well, this is what we want to do, this is what we want to create, not necessarily representing Hong Kong, and I think several of you have said that. And then, I don't want to call you map office, but when you had mentioned that this particular guest had said that it was always different every year. Do any of you feel sort of a concern that the idea of M Plus being the curator, because it's a government initiative, that this will then become a managed process rather than sort of an organic process? Because, you know, all of you here represent the years when, you know, when this has not been trying to be a Hong Kong, we're great at art, look at how we're focusing on it, but you were all, you know, moving forward and on ideas based on your own creativity, you happen to be here. So do you guys have any thoughts about that?
I will certainly not talk about all the edition of the Biennale, but I can talk about the one that I was taking part of, and also I could talk about the architecture one, which also I took part of a couple of years after, and every time has been a tremendous struggle for different reasons, time-wise, management, finance. And that has some impact on the curatorial or artistic development. Then I think that the model that we have been part of was not working. Honestly speaking, in terms of management, was quite bad. retrospectively. And I've been taking part of a lot of Biennale. Then trying some other model, I think that soon we will know about if this model works or not, and some decision will be taken. But I also only report on the one that I was part of.
Well, I really think it's a good thing that M+, you know, try to collaborate with ADC this time. Of course, there is a lot of difficulties, especially the comments from the general public, and also from the artists is not that positive. But I think seeing, but M+, I think the staffs in M+ really know how to negotiate with ADC in order to get a better deal in terms of time management and also the professional mechanism, how to make the event more successful. And obviously, this time you can see Leaky is getting a better coverage of media and also building better connections in Venice. I mean, by the observation that I saw in these few weeks. So, but there is another worry that M+ will take over this event, and but of course this is only speculation. No one knows yet. I hope that the platform will still be open to the local artists and different ideas can contribute to the future participation of the event, rather than just put it part of M+ program and dictated in terms of forms and also the selection of artists and even taste of the so-called official taste from them. So this is my opinion.
Well, I guess from the perspective of whether the experience of putting up exhibition in Venice Biennale can be articulated, from this perspective, I think with a museum to taking care of it, it would be a good option, because the museum, no matter it is an Empress or Museum of Art, but the museum have a group of curator, more experienced curator and more younger curator. It would be a good chance for this institution to pass on the experience of curating international exhibitions. Empress, I guess we do have a lot of expectation on this young institution in Hong Kong. If we perhaps not very satisfied with the Museum of Art in the previous years, it do makes us have such hope. And this is the first time, I think, well, I just look from all the media coverage. I think this time the artists probably get a better exposure in the Venice Biennale when compared with the previous one. And I think we do need to have some time to look forward. We have already tried different model of curating Hong Kong Biennale. At this point, I don't think we really have a final decision which model is the best one, but we keep on trying different models. I think that's the case.
我用翻中文講，我覺得每一次唔同嘅 edition 出現嘅時候咧，其實你會見到有好同埋唔好嘅嘢出現嘅。咁我哋都見到ADC 盡量係將嗰個經驗都有個總結，然後第二年都會。 即係同大家講翻係可以有啲咩改善，咁亦都因為係每一年個 model 都有啲唔同，同埋做嘅人都唔同啦，咁所以咧嗰個 pavilion 咧就變咗每一年都喺出邊嘅人睇就話點解香港好似個 style 每一年都唔同，咁呢個其實係一個活力同埋一個都係好香港嘅事嚟嘅，因為香港嘅 style 其實都幾混雜同埋幾嗰個。 好流動嘅，咁所以如果 如果將來我哋係會有一個 team 嘅 curators 或者係有一個 museum 去繼續主辦威尼斯雙年展嘅話，好容易就會變成係一個一件佢哋已經做慣做熟嘅事，咁就未必會有嗰、那個那個變數或者嗰個活力喺裏邊。咁所以我成日都覺得ADC 以前嘅做法去同民間嘅或者係 independent 嘅 curator 去合作去做，係呢個係有個好處。咁我都覺得其實 M Plus 都可以考慮。即係會繼續係會喺民間度或者揾一啲 independent 嘅 curator 同佢哋一齊去做咯。
我有個又唔係正面又唔係負面嘅睇法嘅，因為咧我哋要睇翻其實當代藝術係咩嚟㗎嘛？當代藝術就係一個全球化嘅一個其中一個層面嘅呈現嚟嘅，咁。剛才大家都很清楚明白講到這些大型展覽，你講緊的就是 network， 講緊的就是 teamwork， 講緊的就是錢。而過去那幾屆，我們譬如我親身參與的，或者見到我們朋友參與的，所謂獨立的香港的 curators， 對著這幾樣問題，即是拗爆頭都解決不到的問題。所以在現在這個這趨勢一路做下去的時候，M Plus 出現在這件事上參與是一個自然不過的事，所以這個不是好或者不好 的現象，是必然的現象。這樣的時候呢，我們就好像剛才陳玉強很清楚地看到那個和以往的藝術家得益的地方是在哪裡嘛，其實就是這樣而已。接著下一波又會滾了什麼其他東西出來呢？ 那個其實又是另外一種自然的發展。這個已經嗰個全球化嗰個巨輪咧，都唔係你一個 curator、一個 artist 或者任何一個獨立個體咧可以阻礙到嘅一個巨輪嚟嘅。咁我嘅睇法就係咁樣。
多謝。嗱，因為時間啦，我就再次多謝 M Plus 安排今日嘅節目。我想是不是蛙王有個 performance 就會完成今天的 panel 呢？多謝大家出現。
come up here to fight. When you go to the come up here to play together. The white people. You carry, you carry this like a set design. I have been long time no chance. Attack you people. Here, I prepare 100 shikha. This shikha. Thank you.
到時再見到大家。